Welcome to Mason, Ohio for the nightcap of the 2021 Big East Baseball Tournament presented by Jeep. Fans piling in for the highly anticipated return of the UConn Huskies to this storied event and their rematch with three-time Big East Tournament champion Xavier. It is the Huskies and the Musketeers from Prasco Park. Good evening, folks. Matt Schumacher, Mike Schmaltz with you. John Fanta will be joining us shortly from the dugout. Mike, a highly anticipated rematch. This regular season series split 2-2. They were separated by just one run.
It was amazing. It was 29 runs for the Musketeers, 28 runs for the UConn Huskies. UConn was just coming off a COVID pause and kind of getting back in their groove. And the Musketeers were able to eke out a couple wins. The big game in that series was a 15-13 game. It was actually suspended, and the next day it went 12 innings.
The winner of this game will get the Creighton Blue Jays, who improved to 7-0 all-time in the Big East Tournament against Seton Hall. They did it in walk-off fashion, down 3 going into the ninth inning. Will Hanifin, the hero for the Blue Jays.
A four-run bottom of the ninth and a walk-off double for Hanifin. Amazing stuff is that game combined for 15 runs, 25 hits. Seton Hall left 11 on base, and Creighton left 9 on base. But what we did learn, Matt, is don't leave early, because a lot of things can happen late in this tournament.
If this game is anything like what we had in game one, we're going to be in for a very fun and perhaps lengthy Thursday night here from Prasco Park.
Well, it's a beautiful night for baseball. Why not stay a little bit extra?
It is. Fans continuing to file in here at Prasco Park. Everything is free.
It's amazing.
We love the folks here at Prasco. This is the third straight year that the Big East has held the tournament here in Mason, Ohio, just outside of Cincinnati. Admission is free. Food is free. Drinks are free. The entertainment is free. It's a kid-friendly park. If you're in the area and watching this, come on out to the ballpark. We'll be here until Sunday. Four teams, 4 days, double elimination. One team will be crowned kings of the Big East Tournament.
It'll be amazing. It should be very competitive. All the coaches we spoke with yesterday during the workout sessions were ready for close games. We got one 8-7 in the opener, and I think we're going to see another one here in game two.
We will be back in just a moment from Prasco with starting lineups and first pitch between the UConn Huskies and the Xavier Musketeers.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Back from the Big East Baseball Tournament presented by Jeep here at Prasco Park in Mason, Ohio. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for the three-time Big East Tournament champion Xavier Musketeers. And boy, they have got some experience in this lineup. Look no further than Natale Minostra in the four spot.
Yeah, he's been a rock for this program. He's been a leader. He's been the epitome of what Billy O'Connor wants that program to be. They've had to mess around a little bit with the lineup, mix it up a bit, and trying to find something that sticks. Luke Franzoni's a power hitter. They got him leading off, and that's all due to an injury to Ryan Altenberger, which was suffered in that UConn series. He's their 377 hitter. He really hasn't played since April 26th.
Yeah, and you really cannot underestimate what his loss means to this Xavier team, but Billy O'Connor said it's next man up mentality, and they'll have to have that tonight against the All-Big East second-teamer Austin Peterson, who has gone at least five innings in all five of his Big East starts this season.
Well, that in a lot of sports, you talk about bus guys. Those are the biggest guys you want coming off the bus to make a statement to your opponent. That's one of about 10 that UConn has on its roster this season. He was originally recruited by Purdue, went to Wabash Valley College, and then transferred in to UConn. He's had a fantastic year, 2.75 ERA, 6-1, and he went 5 against the Musketeers, struck out 8 last time.
6'6", 206.
Hello.
And he can pump it in there. The Musketeers, though, did get after him a little bit in that series. Alex Hellman, who we'll see later on tonight, batting in the 7th spot for Xavier, homered off of Peterson in that series in April. Our umpires tonight, Wayne Krause behind home plate, Brian Drury at first, Keith Sedgety at second, and Joe Cruz, our home plate umpire from game one, over at third base. It was an exciting marathon-type game in game one. This rematch tonight, highly anticipated. As we talked about, Mike, it was a series in the regular season that was separated by just one game. And was separated by just one run, and it was split 2-2. As you get a look at the Huskies' defense, Stock, Winkle, and Fedko in the outfield. Of course, Kyler Fedko, the Big East Player of the Year. And then Brown, Bushling, Christian Fedko, the brother of Kyler, at second. Reggie Crawford, who can flat-out rake the baseball offensively at first. And Pat Winkle, one of the best catchers not only in this league, but in the country, behind the plate. And there are plenty of scouts in the stands tonight who are here to see Pat Winkle.
And we'll have a lot to watch on both sides.
There is Billy O'Connor, a three-time Big East tournament champ as an assistant under Scott Guggins, who's now at the University of Cincinnati. He's never won one as a head coach. But he told us coming into game one tonight, we will put it all on the line as if this is the only game we have to win in this tournament.
Yeah, he flat out told us his second and third starters are available for relief here. And a lot of crowd noise here as we get rolling as the Musketeer home faithful are getting behind Luke Franzoni.
First pitch of the game from Peterson is a strike on the inside corner. First baseman Luke Franzoni down in the count 0-2.
Franzoni hit a walk-off home run earlier in that first series with UConn to win one. He's an outfielder by trade. He was hitting deeper in the lineup. They moved him up front. Billy O'Connor says he moved him there to try to have a guy lead off that can make it 1-0 on one pitch.
He's a type of guy who, as Billy O'Connor said, has been very streaky throughout the course of the season. When he's on, he could change the dynamic of the game by himself. 0-for-7 in his last 7 plate appearances, though. The 0-2 popped out of play.
Made a big-time debut in this tournament, hitting 3 home runs in his first appearance. And as he's matured through his season and his career, he's gotten more patient. There was an example of it there, fouling off a close pitch in a tight count.
Another 0-2 from Peterson. And a good eye from Franzoni.
Peterson working low in the zone early, as you might expect from a power pitcher. Coming in straight heat.
Peterson, a breaking ball on the dirt. And the count level at 2 apiece.
Always interesting on the first batters, how much does the pitcher want to show? How much of your portfolio do you want to get out there? Sometimes you do it intentionally. Sometimes you do it because you need the out.
And Peterson will get the out, pulling the string on the off speed. One away.
That ball started at Franzoni's hip and broke right across the inside corner. Fantastic placement, and that's why the scouts are in the stands. Look at that ball right at the knees.
Peterson's an interesting story. He began his career at Purdue, stayed in state from Chesterton, Indiana, and he was the best freshman on the staff, led the freshman pitchers in pretty much every major statistical category. As he takes on Jack Hausinger, it's popped high but shallow in the left, and Stock is there to make the play. Two gone. But he wanted a change of scenery after his freshman year, so he took a year off of D1 ball, went to the JUCO ranks, and then found his way to UConn to pitch under the tutelage of 10th year pitching coach Joshua McDonald. And boy, has that worked out pretty well.
Absolutely worked out. Joshua McDonald, part of the longest tenured college baseball staff in the country. Talking to the UConn players yesterday, say it's a great environment to improve. They make it fun to play. And clearly they've attracted some of the best talent in the country.
Andrew Walker right back up the middle, and the first base hit of the contest for Xavier comes with two outs in the first.
Well, the Musketeers, the four seed, important not to go down at least without a hit in your first at bat. And Walker stays right on this. Good fastball up, drills it right up the middle.
And Walker, absolutely a threat to steal. 15 stolen bags this season in 16 attempts with Big East tournament veteran Natale Manastra at the dish. In his sixth season in a Xavier uniform, and Billy O'Connor joked he's never letting him leave.
Yeah, exactly.
He's got to stay.
Well, he said he's been the epitome of the program. You want to point to that guy and say, do what he does. And he's a leader for the veterans. He's a leader for the young players that come into the program. And he just glows and beams when he talks about Natale Manastra.
As does every pitcher on the staff for Xavier, which we'll talk about more in the bottom half of the first. Musketeers, though, trying to take advantage of a runner on. And two down for Manastra, the 1-1. And a pitch out was on, with the speedy Walker taking a big lead at first base.
Xavier hasn't stolen a ton of bases this season, but Billy O'Connor understands how to put pressure on a defense. See Manastra shaking his head, got out in front of that off-speed pitch. And he resets. Just a baseball guy, understands what he's supposed to do with the plate.
Musketeers 7-3 in their last 10 games. UConn 25-5 in their last 30. Runner takes off, ball in the dirt, and an easy steal for Andrew Walker. That's his 16th of the year.
So runner in scoring position now for Natale Manastra. Xavier trying to make an opening statement with one of its best hitters.
Led the team this year with both hits and RBI, drove in 30 runs this season. But the breaking ball rings him up, looking on the outside corner. Two strikeouts in the inning for Austin Peterson. He gets out of a runner in scoring position with two out jam. We'll be back with the Xavier Musketeers in the field and UConn at the dish.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix, Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway.
Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose.
I chose Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now?
And now.
I am.
I am.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints collectively shaping and forever changing what makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
Getting set to start the bottom of the first here from Prasco Park as we take a look at the UConn Huskies starting lineup. Presented by Jeep. Eric Stock leads it off. He's a Big East all-first teamer. And, you know, this is a team in UConn, Mike, that had six players earn all Big East accolades this season.
Oh, it's unbelievable, and it's well-deserved. You look down these numbers, 402, 318. There's really not a weak spot in the averages. And Kyler Fedko, of course, in there with those big 46 RBI for the campaign. So no easy spot here in this lineup for Nick Zwock tonight.
So this UConn starting nine will go up against Nick Zwock, the all Big East first teamer, who went the distance, seven innings, six hits, no runs, eight strikeouts in his win against UConn back in April.
Yeah, that was a 5-0 victory, so the Musketeers gave him some good run support in that start as well. And Zwock's ready to go here. This is his final season here with the Musketeers. He's working with his battery mate, Natale Minastra. One of the first things Zwock said when he considered coming back is, Natale coming back.
Right.
Will he be part of the program? Because they've worked together for so long. Trying to put a nice victory together here for the Musketeers to open up this tournament.
So here is Kyler Fedko leading things off for UConn, the Big East Player of the Year. And he looks at a ball low and outside. Fedko hit 402 during the regular season, 12 doubles, 11 home runs, and 46 runs batted in 45 games played.
Yeah, Jim Pender says he gives him that George Springer kind of vibe. George Springer, of course, the great Houston Astro that came out of the program. And not the fact that he's, you know, one-to-one comparable to George Springer, but he has those instincts that you just can't teach.
Here's the 1-1 from Zwock. And it's low. Yeah, it's funny you bring up George Springer and the team that he was part of. That's actually the last time until this season that UConn won a Big East regular season championship. As Fedko sprays it foul and out of play.
I think with all the success they had in the American Conference, nationally ranked, perennially top 25, top 15, RPI tonight, they come in with a 21. And the track record's just been incredible with UConn. If you look at it too, the American Conference a little bit stronger in baseball. Eastern Carolina's in that league. Southern Mississippi's in that league. So you got to bring your A game every night in that American Conference.
Well, and UConn has been runners up in that tournament out of the American Conference the last two seasons they played in that tournament. But of course, they won the Big East back in 2013, their last year before exiting to the American. And Fedko draws a close call walk and heads up to first base. And UConn has a man on with nobody out.
Well, there's a first thank you card from Kyler Fedko to home plate umpire Wayne Krause. Hey, thanks. Appreciate that. That didn't miss by a whole lot.
No,
you could
it
give
not.
It a little bit low. Fedko watched that go really, really close to the black there.
So that gives way for Chris Winkle. the left-handed hitting center fielder who helped recruit his brother, Pat Winkle, to the team. Good lead at first for Fedko. He's stolen six bags this year. He talked, Mike, about the prestige of this UConn program. Of course, they won that Big East tournament back in 2013 as the 8 seed. They have won this tournament 3 times, the other 2 times coming in the 90s. But that year, back in 2011, which included big leaguers George Springer, Matt Barnes, Nick Ahmed, they went to the Super Regional, which is the farthest that UConn has gone in the modern 64-team NCAA tournament era. And Jim Penders feels like this team has the talent and the depth to not only duplicate, but perhaps get all the way to Omaha for the College World Series.
Well, those three names you just mentioned, it's hard to believe that team didn't go a lot
no
further.
No kidding.
So the talent's been impressive. And it's interesting because you don't nationally think of UConn as sort of a traditional baseball school. It's more your ACC, SEC teams. And a lot of times they'll matriculate to UConn because they come from the New Jersey area, they come from the Philadelphia area where college sports really don't dominate the landscape. It's more a professional town. The kids make their way to UConn and the best of them make their way up there.
Well, it's funny you bring that up because the other day USA Today did an article that was titled Basketball-Centric UConn Proving It's Also a Baseball School. And Jim Penders said, look, I'm cool with coaching at a basketball school.
Right.
I keep a basketball in my office to remind me that the big round orange ball is the reason we're able to recruit the kids that we're able to recruit. As Winkle looks at a ball outside, it's now 2-2. But they have slowly but surely, over the years, built up a formidable power in the Northeast.
Yeah, it's a team you don't want to face, but they will get good games. They will be invited on the road. They played earlier this season at Texas Tech. So they've got that respect, and they can go out and get those games that will get them into the stronger RPI categories.
Winkle to first. Franzoni over to second base. The throw back is not in time, much to the chagrin of the Xavier Musketeer faithful at the first base line. And Billy O'Connor wants the umpires to get together on this one.
Yeah, Jack Hasinger had a pretty good turn there at short, and it was pretty close over there at first. We saw, what, 3 or 4 reviews in game one today? We'll see what we look at here. Yeah, I think he's going to end up being safe. Yeah, it's always interesting. Winkle kind of jumping high in the air, so he thought it was close. And that's one of those maybe audible calls for the umpire. You want to hear the leather, and then you want to hear for the thud on the back.
It's Brian Drury, the first base umpire. Wayne Krause had a pretty good look at it, too, at home plate.
Matt, I think there's some free ice cream or some of that free Montgomery Inn over there because those guys have made a couple visits over there and they stay for a while.
Well, you can't come all the way to Mason, Ohio, just outside of Cincinnati, and not get Montgomery Inn.
Longtime barbecue restaurant here, known for its ribs, known for its pulled pork.
And their
sauce. It's the sauce. The sauce is what makes it.
Yeah, the sauce is what makes it.
There's a little brown sugar in that, I understand. One of the secret ingredients.
Oh, good. Don't tell me the rest.
That was leaked to me by John Franta.
I could drink that sauce.
Absolutely.
So the call on the field right now is that the runner was safe. Winkle running it out, and the call is confirmed. So Winkle beats it out on the fielder's choice. But Xavier does get the lead runner and Kyler Fedko at second base. Here's one more look at it. Bang, bang.
Yeah, he
did get there. The tie goes to the runner.
He might have been a half step
pitcher or batter
ahead of that throw. A really small half step, but still a half.
So Chris Winkle at first base with a good lead. He stole 14 bags during the course of the 2021 campaign. And he's got Eric Stock at the dish.
Stock, a converted infielder. He played a little in Old Dominion. he's come into the outfield and said he really took to it sort of naturally. So they've left him out there and obviously been a big contributor.
Jim Pender said he actually never even took a fly ball in the outfield out at Old Dominion.
Said they started hitting fly balls. He naturally went back on it pretty well. He can play a lot of different positions, but
having
his
bat in the lineup is important. Drills it out to right field, tailing towards the line. Giving chase is Schultz, and it goes off the wall. Runner will hold at third. It's a one-out double for Eric Stock.
So runners in position for Stock. We just talked about his bat. That ball left over the outside portion of the plate, about belt high. You're going to see Stock just do a great piece of hitting. Just go right with it. Lead it down the line. And a little bit late over there for the Musketeers, Garrett Schultz.
And now Stock 3-for-4 this year with a pair of doubles against Nick Zwock. So now second and third for the lefty cleanup hitter, Pat Winkle, who's been one of the best catchers in all of college baseball this season and a big reason why there are so many scouts in the stands here tonight at Prasco Park. One down, two on. Go ahead, run 90 feet away.
It's be a good test for Zwock here. His first real trouble spot, obviously in your first inning. Trying to hold UConn down. This is where you reflect upon that 8 strikeout performance you had the first time around.
Oh, one is low. Interestingly, Pat Winkle, who hit 290 during the course of the regular season with 11 homers, went 0-for-17 in the 4-game series here in Cincinnati at Xavier back in April. Really struggled against the Musketeers staff.
That's a shocking stat to hold him 0-for-17 in a series.
It's hit high and deep to center field. Alex Hellman back on it and against the wall makes the catch. Winkle, Chris Winkle that is, will tag from third, and Stock goes from second to third. It's a 1-0 lead for UConn.
Situational hitting. All you got to do is get something into the air to score the run. And that was well deep enough, right out at the 400 sign. Musketeers almost had a bad relay coming home. Housinger threw it wide of the plate. Monaster was able to track it down. That could have been a one-run throwing error. We could easily have a 2-0 game.
So now Christian Fetko, the brother of Kyler, two sets of brothers in the starting lineup for the UConn Huskies. He takes to the plate with two outs. Grounded to Housinger at short. And the throw across the diamond in time to end the inning. UConn plates a run and they lead it 1-0 as we head to the second inning from Prasco Park.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances, designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cashback rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
It's a 1-0 lead for the UConn Huskies as we get set to start the top of the second, and we now welcome in the third member of our team, John Fanta.
Matt, Mike, good evening. Well, I was talking with UConn pitching coach Josh McDonald about Austin Peterson and his journey to Connecticut, because you think about it, it starts at Purdue, then it ends up at Wabash Valley Community College in Illinois. So how does a kid at Wabash Valley end up with the UConn Huskies? Well, it actually started with Wabash Valley's pitching coach making a phone call to Josh McDonald, the UConn pitching coach, and saying, hey, this Austin Peterson kid, he could win a lot of games for you, and I think he could be great for you. Josh McDonald never saw Austin Peterson pitch live. Austin Peterson, after his pitching coach at Wabash Valley said to UConn, you could use him, Peterson called UConn himself. He basically recruited himself into the Huskies program, and now here he is pitching in game one of a postseason.
It's amazing how you make those connections in baseball, and now, folks, moving around even more, it's just a phone call away and, you know, really change your career.
Yeah, great insight from John Fanta, embedded in the dugouts this evening after calling the walk-off winner for Creighton earlier today. Here is Jared Cushing down in the count 1-2. And he's able to fight it off against Peterson. And, you know, to that point that John made about the coaching staff at Wabash Community College saying he could win a lot of games at this level. He has. He's 6-1 this season with a 2.75 ERA. And I think even more impressive, Mike, opponents batting less than 200 against him this season. There's a pop-up down the right field line. Crawford in foul territory. And one gone in the top of the second.
We'll see how well the Musketeers can work counts here. Trying to get back in. Strike a little bit of a blow, get that run back. Here's a guy, Tyler DeMartino, described as not the best athlete on the team, but man, he can hit, and he's locked in. He's a transfer in from West Virginia University.
First pitch swinging, and he squirts it through the hole into left field.
And that's why he's in the lineup. Had just enough to get it past the shortstop, Zach Bushling. And you need those. Seton Hall Pirates, game one, had about three of those in a row to put some pressure on the Creighton Blue Jays.
That's DeMartino's ninth hit in the last seven games. Swinging the bat well coming into the tournament. How much do we talk about momentum at this time of the year? And certainly gives them an opportunity towards the back end of the lineup. Here is the seven-hitter, Alex Hellman.
Well, Hellman, similar to Peterson, transfers in from Arizona State through a connection that Billy O'Connor had with his college coach, now out at Arizona State. Said they weren't maybe going to get the right opportunities or as many opportunities as he wanted, and your former college coach calls you and says, hey, I think you can use this guy, and here he is.
Homered off Peterson in that series at Xavier University back in April, which Jim Penders said is the only reason UConn is even playing in this tournament. There was a point where the Huskies thought they would not reach the 14-game minimum to qualify for this tournament due to a number of COVID-related issues that suspended long stretches of their season. In fact, they missed 2 weeks leading up to that Xavier series.
They did, and they were coming out of it, and that series was supposed to be a Friday-Sunday with a couple doubleheaders in there. They moved it to a Sunday-Tuesday. Yeah, Jim Penders gives a lot of credit to Billy O'Connor. Earned a lot of respect, a bunch of mutual respect between them built in that series. And Penders said, you know, Billy O'Connor's a competitor. He wanted to beat us four times, so that's why he made all the accommodations to get that done.
Count is 2-2, one down, DeMartino at first. He represents the tying run. To Bushling at short, the flip to second, and now Fedko on to first, and a beautiful stretch by Reggie Crawford. It's a 6-4-3 double play to end the inning. How about this turn?
Ground ball, double play, pitcher's best friend. Connecticut out of the inning.
This is the Seton Hall story, one that comes to life every day on our campus. This is the place where great minds discover.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix. Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway. Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints collectively shaping and forever changing what makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
It is a capacity crowd here at Prasco Park in Mason. Night number one of the Big East Baseball Tournament. UConn up 1-0 on Xavier in the second inning. On the flip side of this pitching matchup for Xavier, Nick Swack getting the ball tonight, and he's someone who in high school showed the leadership abilities. Why? Because he not only was a great pitcher on the rubber, he was the quarterback for the Monticello High School football team, and he also played hockey as well. When we talked with Billy O'Connor and the Xavier coaching staff yesterday, guys, they said that Swack is the type of guy that you can trust in any situation. Give him the ball here tonight, and he's got to find a way to keep this UConn offense at bay, an offense that last weekend scored 48 against Seton Hall.
Great point, John. Outscored Seton Hall in a series sweep, 48-11. Here is Reggie Crawford, who has a big old swing, as we saw in the practice rounds yesterday. He was launching balls all over the park, including deep to the porch out in right field.
Matt, it was scary. We were down there in the on-deck circle, and, you know, the contact hurt our ears. It was noticeable, audible.
Well, I, silly as I am, ventured out to right field while Reggie Crawford was taking his BP rounds, and I was on my phone sending an email when all of a sudden a ball soared right over my head, second deck in right field. And I looked down, and sure enough, it was Reggie Crawford, and I thought, my goodness, we might be in for some fireworks this weekend at Prasco Park.
Yeah, you look at him, and he's just a major league prototype body build. He looks like a hitter, and here he is.
Laces it into right, and that's a leadoff single for Reggie Crawford.
And you just mentioned all that power, and here's some UConn discipline at the plate again. That ball, a little bit, he had to reach for it. Didn't try to do too much with it, just knocked it in and got himself on base. Saw him get the hands extended, just kind of sweep that through the hole there.
55 runs right batted now in for the All Big East first teamer in 45 games played. And now he passes the bat down the line to David Langer, the designated hitter tonight for the Huskies.
Yeah, you, Matt, you made the observation. He's got a 40-point higher batting average than he did in 2019. He's a humble guy, hardworking guy. Had some timely hits for Connecticut through the years. Good contact guy to have in this situation. Nobody out in your leadoff runner on.
1-0. The 0-1, rather, makes it a 1-1 count with Crawford at first. Langer was 2-for-2 against Wach in the series opener at Xavier back in April, including a double off the wall over at Victory Parkway.
The on-base percentage at .417.
Rips it down the left field line, and that'll be extra bases. Crawford rounding second, coming into third, and he'll be held up there on a double for David Langer.
Langer absolutely barreled that, and if you're a Xavier fan, you're a little concerned about how hard the contact is against Nick Zwack. That's just textbook hitting. Got Great movement with the hips out in front of that. Ripped it right down the line. Matt, this is the kind of momentum that the Huskies built in that last series.
Well, it's funny that John brought up the fact that the Huskies are coming off 48 runs in four games, because Jim Penders talked to us yesterday saying he was frightened by the contact that they were putting on baseballs. And he said, I think you could have put the Yankees out there and we would have given them a run for their money.
Yeah. How much baseball has he coached to be able to say that?
And a lot of major
from that
leaguers.
Perspective, absolutely.
All right, so Chris Brown at the dish. Two in scoring position, nobody out. You get the sense that this could be a game-changing inning here early on for UConn.
Mad Mike, to your point, I was talking with Villanova head coach Kevin Mulvey last week. He said that on UConn's best day, he believes their lineup could compete with a AAA team. That's how high he is on some of these guys.
Good Lord.
Brown ropes it deep down the left field line, but fouled. That is crazy to think about. Coming from an opposing coach, you know, it's one thing for Jim Penders, maybe a little tongue-in-cheek to say that about the Yankees, but for an opposing coach in this league to say that UConn can compete with a AAA baseball team, that's saying a lot.
Matt, this squad hasn't played that many games. 46 for a college team, 55 RBI for Reggie Crawford, 46 for Kyler Fedko. It's well-founded.
There's the 1-1 to Brown. Brown himself, 30 RBI in 136 plate appearances. And when your eight hitter has a slugging percentage of 434, you know you've got a dangerous lineup. Two balls and a strike, nobody out, two on.
Zwak's starting to fall behind here. He's known for his poise, but you wonder if he's pressing just a bit. UConn's starting to make that great contact. 23 pitches now for Zwak.
Three and one. A full count to Chris Brown.
Good comeback there for Zwak to have the confidence in the breaking ball to throw it in that situation.
Big pitch here for Nick Zwak. Fought off and out of play. Remember, the last time these teams faced off against each other was Zwak on the mound. He went the distance in game one of a doubleheader, seven innings, six hits, no runs, and eight strikeouts. It appears UConn making better contact this time around against the tall lefty for Xavier. Payoff. Brown puts it into the gap in right field, and that'll score everybody. Coming in from second, here is David Langer, and it's back-to-back doubles for the Huskies.
Timely hitting, wins championships. UConn's displaying it here in the second inning now, a two-run inning, nobody down. And Matt, circumstantially, that UConn team that Xavier played was just coming out of that pause. They were just kind of getting their feet back under them. And with that series that they just came off with the 48 runs, they are motoring here coming into this tournament and the momentum continuing.
So it's a three-run lead for UConn. Nobody out, runner at second base. And the Xavier pitching coach, Brian Furlong, brings in the entire infield as he has a chat with Nick Zwak. This is a guy who is Big East All-First Team. And we talked about it with the first game, Creighton and Seton Hall, and how important it is to have momentum. Who are the hot teams coming into the tournament? Certainly
UConn
is that.
No question.
I don't think there is a hotter team in this tournament, at least at the plate, than the Huskies.
Well, Nick Zwack's a competitor, and Billy O'Connor said a little bit yesterday, similar to his head coach, Zwack runs a little bit hot sometimes. And that's where Natale Minostra has come in to be able to settle him down in previous moments of pressure. We'll see what Minostra can maybe work a little magic here.
Here's a lefty, Bushling. Thought about a bunt attempt, pulled back on ball one.
There's Zwack keeping it low. That one a little too far outside. He's trying to keep it out of the strike zone.
Here's the 1-0, and that misses low.
There might not be a hotter team in the country, gentlemen. This UConn team's won 25 of their last 30 games, and their RPI is up to 20, according to the Warren Nolan report. So they feel pretty good about their at-large chances, regardless of what happens this weekend, and rightly so. Their non-conference strength of schedule is in the top 40 in the country. They've challenged themselves, and they are scalding.
The 2-0 is laced down the right field line, and that'll score Brown from second base. Bushling motoring into second, and he's in with a head first slide. Three straight triples for the UConn Huskies, and they lead it 4-0 here in the second.
And I don't know what else you can do if you're Nick Zwack. You're not throwing poor pitches. You're putting it where you want it. That ball just about chest high, inside portion of the plate. What do you do with those types of pitches? You rip them down the line.
And that's your nine-hole hitter.
Yeah, how about that?
Not bad for turning the lineup over.
Great way to turn it over.
Back to the top of the order now. Second time through for Kyler Fedko, who drew a walk to lead off the ball game. Still nobody out, and a runner at second base. Nobody in the pen for Xavier.
You know, Matt, a lot of times you want to stage a hit about every three batters so you keep your lineup moving, keep it churning. Jim Peters doesn't have to worry about that. He's got nine of them. So Zwack battling now, but behind 2-0. And still, Matt, nobody out here in the inning. They've already got three across.
Two-oh to Fedko. Strike on the inside corner.
So now for Zwack, just kind of work his way back, piece by piece. I don't think his confidence is rattled at all because of his veteran status. He's got to hone in and try to keep this ball out of the zone.
Good rip from Fedko. Swung out of his helmet almost. And it's 2-2.
And on the other side of that, if you're UConn, you can just wait. You can wait to walk out. You can find a pitch that you want to hit. You know he's going to try to nibble. You know he's going to try to make you fish. But you're up 4-0. You can sit on some of this, be patient, and find one to drive.
Two and two. Foul tip into the mitt of Minostra. And there is finally one gone here in the second.
There's a competitiveness for Zwack. Came back at his first strikeout. Outside pitch. Low portion of the plate. Got one of the best hitters in the country to swing and miss.
The top 10 with that batting average. 4-0-2. And now Chris Winkle.
There's really something to be said as well about the mentality factor in this game, guys. We were talking with Jim Penders, the UConn head coach, yesterday, and just talked about being the one seed and being the regular season champions, and you would have thought that his team had lost 10 in a row heading into this tournament. I mean, he was harsh, but that's just the mentality part of it. He said, we've earned nothing. We've done nothing. The expectation every year is for UConn baseball to be the Big East champions, and we need to show the rest of this field this week that that's what this program is. So I think it's fascinating, the layer to this game. Xavier has been the gold standard in terms of consistency in the Big East. They own three conference tournament titles, 2014, 16, and 17. And here you have UConn. The last year they were in the Big East, Matt, as you said earlier, they won the Big East title. And there's something to be said about the Huskies returning here this week to show the rest of the conference that they are, in fact, back.
Here's a pop-up in the left. Walker under it to glove, two away. Yeah, John, that's a great point, and I believe it was Mike.
Yes, it was. I was going to say that.
Yesterday, you know, you guys are the favorites. People are expecting you to win.
and he said, goes, by who?
Yeah, who's expecting us to win?
Schmaltology.
I said, all right, maybe not favored, but predicted. I changed my
– And he said, by who?
By who? And I said, your media and your peers in the league, which he was able to accept. He took that one.
So two down, and they decide to intentionally walk Eric Stock after he doubled off Zwock in the first. And that gives way to Pat Winkle, who is 0 for 18 this year against Xavier, but he did drive in a run with a sac fly to center back in the first.
So two down, pretty good move here for the Musketeers to bring the lefty-on-lefty matchup. You bring the force out at third base into play as well.
Lefty on lefties, Walk and Winkle, two on, two out. And a 4-0 lead for UConn. In the bottom of the second. Ground ball, diving play at first by Franzoni. The flip to first, covered beautifully, and in time by Nick Zwock to get out of the jam. It's a three-run UConn inning. Three straight doubles for the Huskies, and they lead it 4-0 as we head to the third in Mason.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Back for game two of the Big East Championship here at Prasco Park in Mason, Ohio. The Musketeers, Xavier trailing the number one seeded UConn Huskies 4-0. Xavier trying to answer a three-run frame by UConn. We're joined now by Adam Baum. He is the Cincinnati Enquirer writer for the Xavier Musketeers, and he was able to bring us a fantastic story last week about Billy O'Connor and his mother, Renee. Here's a bunt right back to the box. Peterson over to first. Nice play by Crawford to get the out. And one down for Xavier early. Adam, there's a connection here. The Musketeers support a charity called Versus Cancer. And through that, the Pediatric Brain Tumor Foundation. Xavier's had fundraisers several years where they shaved their heads. They weren't able to do it this year, but they sponsored strikeouts and walks during the UConn series when it was in town. They were raised about $22,000, but you have another whole layer to this story. Tell us about the connection between Billy O'Connor, the foundation, and ultimately his mother, Renee.
Yeah, when Billy was an assistant here back in 2013, they got involved with this Versus Cancer organization, which, like you said, benefits pediatric brain tumors. And, you know, lo and behold, Billy's mom comes down with a brain tumor of her own a couple years later. She battled it for 5 years, fought like hell. And unfortunately, you know, she lost her battle last year, August 8th, 2020. And this is Billy's first baseball season without his mom. I know I spoke to him. He's still feeling the emotions of it all. And I have a connection with Billy myself. You know, we played high school baseball together, and I got to know Billy's mom and his whole family, and I knew what a great woman she was and what a great family she helped raise. And so I know Billy's thinking about her. He thinks about her every game, and it's a pretty crazy story the way that it all played out. But, you know, it doesn't really seem random to Billy the way that this whole thing unfolded.
Yeah, we often talk about a divine connection between spiritual elements and the game of baseball, but this was very different. Billy O'Connor actually answered a cold email that came in to the team about the foundation, and then 2 years later his mother gets diagnosed with that same condition. And the founder of that program played for North Carolina. The Musketeers went down there, played a game. This ball was lifted out into left field. Nice play by Bushling there at short to get back on that and haul that in for the second out. But I don't talk about that because that really helped Billy, the founder of that program, helped Billy through that period with his mother before she passed away.
Yeah, like you said, you know, North Carolina, Chase Jones, he actually gets a brain tumor himself, and it pretty much shelves his college baseball career. But, you know, Billy gets that email. They start to get involved. Xavier goes down to North Carolina to play a weekend series, and they have Chase Jones come and talk to the team. And then, you know, a couple years later when Billy's mom gets diagnosed and Rainey's going through this battle, you know, Billy starts to lean on Chase Jones, you know, a guy who had battled and beaten a brain tumor of his own. And Billy spoke to me about how valuable that was and how much he really leaned on that relationship and what he got out of it. And, you know, it's hard to believe that this whole thing played out the way that it did, but it certainly makes you think, you know.
This ball rocketed off the fence, and the Musketeers break through here against the Huskies. First extra base hit of the day for Xavier. And that one off the bat of Luke Franzoni. We talked about how they moved him up in the lineup to start creating some opportunities, and comes through with a double. And Adam, just talk about really the tight-knit baseball community and how that all played out.
Yeah, well, you know, if you've ever been a part of a baseball team, it's a small group of guys. You do everything together, and, you know, you get to be silly, you get to lean on one another, and it's just a cool environment. You know, I played baseball, I played basketball, and I played football, but baseball was always the most fun. You know, you get to be with these guys, and you're around them so much, and I got to know Billy pretty well, and I know that baseball is a special sport in that regard, so when one guy's going through something like this, the whole team really rallies around him. And that's why these guys they buzz their heads every year, and they show up and they support their coach the way that they do. It's a special thing, you know.
Two down here for Jack Housinger, runner at second. Count evens at 1-1. Let's talk about your experience with Billy O'Connor through your life. You were a high school teammate of him. What do you respect about him, and how cool is it to see him ascend to the head coaching spot at his alma mater?
It's awesome. In a word, Billy was quite the guy in high school, man. Not only did he play baseball and help lead us to a state championship, but this was a guy who starred on the football field, who was a three-sport athlete. He played basketball at Elder High School, and not only that, but he was one of the smartest guys in his class. His academics were off the charts. That was one thing that I always really respected about him, was that this guy's as busy as anybody at the high school level, and he still puts in the work in the classroom to get it done. I'm not shocked at all that he is where he is today. Got a lot of respect for him and the way he carries himself, and I think Xavier got a really good one.
Adam, thanks for joining us here, and thanks for the insight on Billy O'Connor. Just a very moving story before this tournament.
Absolutely, and Adam has one of the best columns I've ever read for college sports, now, no matter the city. And anytime I'm covering any Xavier event or Cincinnati event in general. I always look for his columns to gain information. Just a super bright and thorough writer and an awesome story. And how about an awesome pickoff move from Austin Peterson catching Franzoni sleeping at second. That ends the inning. UConn leads it 4-0. And we head to the home half of the third after this.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
This is how we ended the top half of the third. Franzoni wasn't quite all there. And Peterson pumped up, fist pumping out of his hat on the spin around pickoff move to get out of the inning.
How about that for passion? You love to see that in any capacity here in collegiate. That's why you follow collegiate athletics, for one. But you just got run support from your team, four-run cushion. And then you return a little bit of the favor, giving a free out there in second base. Great pickoff move, great pickoff play. And the Musketeers' best threat erased. And UConn coming back up here to start the third, bottom of the third.
UConn started off the last inning with four consecutive base hits, including three straight doubles off the wall. It is Christian Fedko to lead things off against Nick Zwack.
So we'll see how Zwack battles back here. Fresh inning, had some time to think about it, reset, consult there with Brian Furlong, his pitching coach. See if he can settle this attack down. And, you know, hitting's contagious, just like a lot of things in baseball. And what are we hashtagging, Big East baseball fever this weekend?
I like it.
I believe that the COVID's gone from UConn. Big East baseball fever right there on the home side.
It is alive and well in that dugout, no question about it. John mentioned the 25 wins over the last 30 games, including six straight coming into the tournament, 48 runs in their last regular season four-game series against Seton Hall, who lost earlier today in a walk-off against Creighton. Thrilling contest in our opening round matchup between the Blue Jays and the Pirates. Certainly a lot of hype about UConn returning to this tournament after they won the last time they were in this league in 2013. And there seems to be a bit of a rivalry amongst the fans and the supporters of UConn and Creighton in particular. Of course, Creighton, the 2019 defending champions. But UConn, last time they were in the conference, they won the tournament.
New kid on the block. So UConn, I think this year's particular battle between the two fan bases is the teams didn't play.
Right.
Due to some scheduling issues, the COVID situation at UConn, the final situation at Creighton as we understand it. So they didn't get to go head-to-head. Creighton had the better record. UConn had the better winning percentage. That's why they're the number one seed.
Here's the 2-2. Fedko watches it sail high and wide, and now a full count to the leadoff man. UConn with a 4-0 lead.
And we heard from Jim Penders in the opening game that, you know, they tried to play it.
Right.
It's not like anybody was ducking anybody. The time, you just run out of time. You get so late into the season, you only have so much time before you have to get your champion decided for the NCAA tournament.
Here is the payoff to Zwack, from Zwack. And he draws a leadoff walk. So that gives way to Reggie Crawford, who singled and scored back in the second inning. We talked about the show that Crawford put on here during batting practice yesterday behind closed doors. But he has 11 homers this year and 55 runs batted in, and he has a major league ready physique.
We saw him just make enough contact to handle a pitch that was up and out of the zone to get it out into right field his first time, and you know, he did not get a full swing on that one, and it still went halfway into the outfield.
Yeah, this is a guy who back in the COVID-shortened 2020 season, they only played 14 games, but he hit .367 with 7 doubles and 16 ribbies, earning freshman All-American honors. And so now he's back for another quote-unquote freshman year. But he is draft eligible next year. And so you've got some scouts in this stadium tonight getting a little taste of what pro ball could look like with a guy like Reggie Crawford wearing your team's uniform.
Scouts lined up behind home plate. You can kind of see some of the radar guns pop up from time to time.
High hopper to second base. They get one, and the turn to first is in time. And that's a 4-6-3 double play.
There's the Musketeer defense coming up to help their number one starter. Just a good relay there. Franzoni with a stretch at first, and you see Nick Zwack with a little nod over Luke, say thank you. High chopper at Cushing. Nice exchange over to Hausinger, who just rips one over to Franzoni. A close one at first, too.
So two down and the base is empty now for David Langer, who doubled off of Zwack back in the second inning.
And that's some great chemistry for a couple of players up the middle here for the Musketeers that really haven't played all that many games together. Cushing was injured, came back for the final series of this season to play at Creighton. He's had a broken finger. He's had a concussion when he collided with Ryan Altenberger. So Altenberger was his shortstop. Hausinger was at third. They've all kind of rotated over to make up for the loss of Ryan Altenberger.
In the right field.
Oh my.
Tracking it down is Schultz up against the wall. And that is a home run for David Langer. Touch them all.
Langer absolutely muscled that ball on the outside portion of the plate over the wall. That's a good probably 330 out that direction. And he got it high enough, Matt, over that raised wall. The black part of the wall that you see there is not an automatic home run. You've got to muscle that over the top of the bricks. And that was a high and outside pitch, and Langer just absolutely muscled that out of the park.
Just his second home run of the season, and it gives UConn a 5-0 lead. Just snuck over the lip of the brick wall, giving a very happy fan out of the porch in right field a souvenir on night one of the Big East tournament.
Well, how about that swing? I thought it was going to be a shaved-off kind of curving ball that was going to the foul line.
I guess it's Taco Thursday here at Prasco Park.
Oppo Taco. Those are very delicious.
Maybe we could get some Montgomery Inn barbecue on a taco.
Perhaps that sauce would work real well. Perhaps we should have an Oppo Taco tent here at Prasco.
I wouldn't be opposed.
John Fanta's ready.
I think he is.
His family's here today. There's some entrepreneurial folks down, a finance major down there in the front row. Get him on that.
Here's the 1-1 to Chris Brown, and it's in the dirt. Now, Mike, you talked about it early in this game, the contact that UConn is making on these pitches against a very good pitcher in Nick Zwack, who shut them out in 7 innings earlier this year. We're seeing something different from this Husky lineup tonight.
Well, that's what Jim Penders was talking about. We're really barreling the ball right now. And we talked to the team about it. And, yes, we came out of the COVID pause. Yes, we had to do some things to kind of get our feet back under us.
And that series with Seton Hall was such a boost to them. As we've already talked about, really showed how potent this offense can be. And they're tearing it up here. 5 runs on 6 hits.
That looked like it almost caught a piece of Brown. He looked back at the home plate umpire, Wayne Krause, who did not award him the base. So instead, it's a 3-ball, 2-strike count with the 9-hitter Zach Buechling on deck. 2 gone here in the bottom of the third. UConn has played at least 1 run in each of the first 3 innings. And Brown goes down on strike. Zwack gets out of the inning with his 2nd strikeout. UConn leads it 5-0 as we head to the 4th from Prasco Park.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances, designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Back from Prasco Park, UConn with an early lead. It's 5-0 as we get set to start the 4th inning. It's been a good outing so far for Austin Peterson. He's allowed 3 hits, no runs, and he's picked up a pair of strikeouts. Takes on Jack Housinger to lead things off for the Musketeers, who are in need of some offense.
Well, here's a good
been
guy.
Able to string together multiple hits in an inning yet tonight.
Here's a good hitter to provide it for the Musketeers, Jack Housinger. Housinger's 484 on the slugging percentage, 302 for the season.
Fourth pitch swinging, lifts it into shallow left. Stock is there to make the play, 1 gone.
You want to know what's helping Austin Peterson as well? It's the pitch count. He's been efficient. Yeah. That was his 40th pitch. And we're through 3. And he's already got 1 out here in the 4th. So now you start thinking complete game for him. How much can that do for your bullpen?
Especially after we saw Creighton have to dip into the bullpen. We saw them use 3 relievers tonight, including their top 2 in Sikowski and Bergstrom. And the winner of this game, of course, will take on Creighton in the winner's bracket tomorrow. Should Xavier lose, they would take on Seton Hall in the first elimination game of the weekend, right here on the Big East Digital Network. The 1-1 to Walker is low. 2 balls and a strike.
Well, the point there for Creighton is Ed Service thinks that his bullpen actually gives him an advantage because of the different styles they can bring out. They can go lefty, righty, high slot, low slot, mid slot. So he can mix it up and match it up a little bit better. So in a way, and I'll put the silver lining on that, maybe nice to get those guys into the tournament action, get them loosened up, and kind of get them thinking that, hey, I'm going to have to contribute here.
The other thing, too, is throughout the course, particularly of the Big East regular season slate, they stretch their bullpen out in preparation for this tournament. Here's the 2-2. Walker fights it off. You know, so often, Mike, we see, even if there is a heavy favorite like we have this weekend in UConn, so often we see this tournament make twists and turns to the final day, and usually it's a war of attrition, particularly with regard to pitching staffs.
It absolutely is. It looked like Seton Hall was going to hang on. Creighton scored 4 in the bottom of the 5th and then combined 9 runs in the last 3 innings of that first game.
Unbelievable.
So you never know when it's going to turn. And that game had 3 or 4 turns of big-time momentum.
Strike 3 call. That is the 3rd of the evening for Austin Peterson, 2 away.
That was the Musketeers' leading average hitter, 311 Andrew Walker, watching a well-placed strike on the inside corner. Good breaking ball. Look at the power. He comes off with the legs. Just ripping that ball in there. I think the one thing that you see out of him, and I know he's throwing some heat here and some great breaking stuff, is the way you kind of fall off towards the first base side. Not the greatest when you're trying to field because you're just off balance. But you know what, Matt? If they're not hitting the ball, you don't have to field. And he misses here 2-0, so one of the rare times he's been behind. And this is Natale Minastra, Musketeers veteran hitter.
And Minastra puts it into the gap in center field. Winkle giving chase, and it bounces off the wall. Minastra rounding into second base, and that's a stand-up two-out double for the sixth-year Xavier catcher.
Second double for the Musketeers of the night. Franzoni picked off its second to end an inning. And now you got Jared Cushing coming up, who's coming off a great series against Creighton. See Minastra wait on his pitch, drove it out there to the gap.
You know, you talked about Cushing's big weekend against Creighton. He went 9-for-17 in four games, three ribbies, a homer, and four runs scored in spite of a broken finger, for which he's wearing a splint on his middle finger for his throwing hand. Oh, by the way, he also had stitches up and down his lip in that series.
Isn't that amazing? So he's playing with a fractured hand. He tried to bunt. That's where he incurred that injury. But to come off and be able to come out and compete like that, a little bit banged up, says a lot.
Well, Billy O'Connor said he's just a hard-nosed warrior. Here's the 0-1. That's hard hit down the third baseline, but just left of the bag and foul. Now, this season he's had a concussion, stitches in his lip, broken finger.
See if we can get a look at this.
There it
at
is,
split. Yeah,
wrapped up. And that's his throwing hand. And he's still in the starting lineup and still playing really good baseball. In spite of all that, the 6'3 sophomore from Naperville, Illinois, who transferred over from Texas Tech after five plate appearances in 2020. 0-2 check swing, appeal to first. And Brian Drury said he held back.
So now you're seeing Peterson get a little more up in the zone. You wonder if he's feeling a little adrenaline here, trying to pump it in with something extra.
One ball, two strikes, two outs. Flair into left field down the line. Stock giving chase, and that's off the wall. Bonastro will score from second. A big roundabout second. Cushing is in with a two-out double. Back-to-back extra base hits, and Xavier is on the board in the fourth.
Well, that's a nice piece of momentum there for the Musketeers, especially to do it with two outs. Cushing able to turn on that pitch. Again, with the broken hand there on the lead hand of the swing. Fantastic rotation. Got underneath that ball, ripped it right down the line. So Xavier able to answer and to do it with two outs. A little something extra there for the Musketeers.
So that gives way to Tyler DiMartino. A runner in scoring position again in two outs. DiMartino singled at his only other at bat tonight off of Peterson.
Fantastic work behind the plate there by Winkle to keep that ball smothered up.
Peterson did give up three runs in five innings against Xavier in his regular season outing against the Musketeers. Tonight, he did seem to have total dominant control through the first three innings. Here's a high pop-up just outside of the infield. Christian Fetko under it. And that ends the inning. However, the Xavier Musketeers chipping away, finally on the board with a pair of two-out doubles. Manastra coming up big. Cushing driving him in. It's 5-1 UConn as we head to the home half of the fourth.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix. Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway.
Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now?
And now.
I am.
I am.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints, collectively shaping and forever changing. What makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
So we've got a new pitcher into the ball game for Xavier as we get set to start the bottom of the fourth. Is the right-hander Dorsey Chatham, Mike, coming in to relieve the starter Nick Zwock.
Well, Dorsey Chatham, one of the younger players here for the Musketeers, that Billy O'Connor mentioned yesterday, might get a chance here. He's got a 5 ERA, the record's at 3-1, it's his 15th appearance. He's worked 18 innings. 20 hits, 22 runs, 10 of them earned, 15 walks. And to bring Dorsey Chatham in here at this juncture tells us a little bit that Billy O'Connor's got some faith his team can come back because he didn't go to Ethan Bosacker and or Lane Flam is 2 and 3 starters.
So some managerial chess here from Billy O'Connor. As we start the bottom of the fourth, it is Zach Buechling in the 9 spot leading things off for UConn. Sam Olson in on the grass at third for the Musketeers, who have tallied 5 hits and 1 run last inning to chip away at this 5-1 lead. Here's the 2-0, and taken low. 3 balls, no strikes to Zach Buechling, who doubled and scored back in the second.
Good job.
Hey, guys.
We're joined now by the Xavier Athletic Director, Greg Christopher. It's a 3-0 coming here from Dorsey Chatham. Chatham comes in with a strike. Well, Greg, Prasco Park full of fans, a lot of them Xavier fans. How nice is it to have this tournament back in Cincinnati?
Yeah, no doubt, guys. Good to have you here with us. Welcome to Cincinnati, and it's a beautiful night at the ballpark. And, yeah, this is not our home field, as you mentioned, but it might as well be because of all the Xavier fans here. And we try to get up here and play a regular season series as well, usually during more normal times. But it does feel like a home field environment for Xavier, no doubt.
One, how nice is it to have just this complex available for, one, a championship tournament and available for a regular season series should you need it?
Exactly. It's a real asset to the city of Cincinnati. The Reds actually used it last year during the COVID season, you know, because there were no minor league, affiliates for the Reds or any Major League Baseball team. But this is an MLB quality setup. So all the minor league teams for the Reds were here, and this was their training site. So, again, the Arrington family, which runs and owns Prasco, incredible generosity to the community, and this is one of the ways they give back to the Cincinnati area, but with this complex and their commitment to youth baseball.
Fedko here, and Housinger going to have that one go off his leg. So first and second now for the Huskies off the new Musketeer pitcher, Dorsey Chatham. Hey, Greg, let's talk a little bit about what goes into hosting as a host institution for a Big East championship?
Well, you've probably seen this. A lot of our staff members are floating around and helping out in different ways. The Prasco company itself, they've got so many of their employees that are helping here. But obviously, it's still a Big East championship, so a number of the Big East staff are here too. So real team effort, but again, it's not quite a home game for our staff, but again, a number of our staff members are here helping out.
Talk a little bit about your baseball program, in particular your head coach, Billy O'Connor, and how much he's been able to build this program, really sustain what the previous head coach, Scott Guggins, was able to do.
You're right, Mike, and you've watched it happen firsthand. Billy's terrific. He runs a really good program, and he knows the DNA of this program. He was a player, played at a high level, had a cup of coffee in the minor leagues, and then got into coaching, and obviously has done quite well. So, we're a fixture in this tournament, seemingly every year, and again, and the future's bright with the recruits he's got coming in, too.
Chris Winkle stands in here. He's got an 0-1 count against Chatham. First and second, nobody out here for the Huskies. You're good with promoting from within and sustaining from within. What makes it special to have a Xavier person in a head coaching role at the institution?
You're right there, Mike. I mean, he understands the university and understands how to get things done within that. And a faith-based institution like Xavier, probably has some quirks, shall we say, in how we, operate, and it's very relationship-based. So we've got a handful of our coaches. Bree, who just won the Big East Championship in women's golf and made it to the NCAA tournament. She played golf for us as well. And then you had Doug Matthews, one of our all-time greats in tennis, running our tennis program. And then Billy. So that familiarity really helps. They understand the institution. They understand the region. And then they certainly understand their sport at a high level.
You got a new facility on campus, or a remodeled facility. Talk a little bit about how you transformed the O'Connor Center, the former O'Connor Center, into the Height Champion Center, and how that's going to benefit soccer and baseball and some of the other sports at Xavier.
What a fun project that was, Mike. And to see that building, it was our old campus rec center. And we built a new rec center on campus. And so that building was sitting there. And we raised the money and then stripped the building literally down to its studs and started from scratch. And a beautiful new home for, as you mentioned, all of our Olympic sports. And when people think of Xavier Athletics, they rightly think of the Cintas Center. But people don't realize that two-thirds of our sports are actually in other facilities. So this was a way for us to bring all those Olympic sports under one roof. Again, terrific facility, brand new locker rooms, training facilities, and really a first-class setup for our Olympic sport teams.
Chatham loses Winkle. Now bases loaded here for the Huskies and a chance to do more damage and really open up this game. And Eric Stock stands in for the Huskies. Stock doubled his first time and walked his second time back in the second inning. Hey, Greg, talk about a little bit of that improvement is going to help us here at the BEDN in some future broadcasts. So talk about some of the infrastructure that went in that's going to help us with our broadcasts coming up.
You're right, Mike. That was a little bit of the hype project, but even more so, the other thing that's going on in the Cintas Center right now, we're adding on to the Cintas Center, building a training center with an extra gym and a new weight room, and then also brand new video board in the Cintas Center this summer. Well, part of that video board project, we actually put in all the infrastructure, wiring, and technology so that we can now do HD games, and this gets above my pay grade here, but the bottom line is we can do HD quality broadcasts over at soccer and at baseball now going forward.
HD good for Matt Schumacher, good for John Fanta, maybe not so much for me, but we appreciate that investment here as we move forward as Chatham delivers here. This ball is lifted out into right field, circling under Garrett Schultz. Schultz will make the catch, tagging and scoring from third for the sixth run, and the Huskies here have tacked on another to answer the Musketeers' run in the top of the first. So 6-1, one down here for the Huskies, and runners at first and third. So Greg, you've also made an announcement that new sport coming to campus in 2 years, I believe. 2022, you will have women's lacrosse.
We will. That's exciting. With the growth of campus over the last 4 years, as far as the number of undergraduate students, one of the things we have to keep track of is the number of student athletes and their proportionality, male and female student athletes, to the student body. And so as our campus has grown a little bit over the last few years, we've basically fallen a little behind on the number of female student athletes. So the best solution for us, we thought, was to add a 19th sport, a new women's sport, women's lacrosse. It's the fastest growing sport in the country, team sport. And as you well know, it's certainly already well established on the Eastern Seaboard. But for us now, it's also really growing in the state of Ohio. I think we're up to 118 high schools in the state of Ohio that have women's lacrosse. So it was a natural fit for us. The first order of business, we just started this week the search process for a head coach. So that'll be our first step.
Franzoni over to Housinger. They get the out at second. But another run in for the Huskies. So two on the board for Connecticut here in the bottom of the fourth, and a 7-1 lead now. But two down for the Musketeers as Chatham tries to work his way through his first inning. Seven runs on six hits now for the Huskies. And standing in, Christian Fetko for the Huskies. Greg, what made lacrosse a good fit in terms of that sport? I know you talked about the growth and the popularity, but why not something like field hockey or a different sport? What other things might have you considered adding at that time?
We did take a look at all the available sports, and the fact that women's lacrosse is already a Big East sport mattered a lot. And then also the facility fit. At the end of the day, we won't have to add any new facilities for women's lacrosse. And had we added field hockey, for example, we need a different surface because they have to play on a very specialized surface. And we did take a look at rowing, too, with the Ohio River and then East Fork. But at the end of the day, we really thought that women's lacrosse was the best fit for what we needed at the time.
Chatham misses high there to Christian Fetko, and it's a 2-0 count now for Fetko. Hey, Greg, we'll let you go on this one, but how nice is it going to be now that we're somewhat emerging from this COVID pandemic? We see fans here tonight, maskless. We see fans sort of the way it was prior to the pandemic. How nice is it going to be to get into the fall sports, the winter sports, and see some crowds back in traditional fashion?
Absolutely, Mike. You know, watching the NBA playoffs in Madison Square Garden last night, you can tell we're turning the corner on all this. So great to see fans back in the stands and some sense of normalcy.
Housinger picks up the final out of the inning, but the UConn Huskies score two. They lead it 7-1. Greg Christopher, thanks for joining us. And we'll
thank
see
you, guys.
Soon.
Will do.
Seven to one UConn as we head to a break here. Moving on to the fifth.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Hey folks, welcome back out to the ballpark, top of the fifth here at a packed Prasco Park. Tickets went on sale Monday, and before the end of the day, they were sold out for all 4 days here in Mason, Ohio. Restricted attendance, but glad to have people back in the ballpark, maskless, sitting shoulder to shoulder. It feels right again at the ballpark. Here's a first pitch swing into deep left field, and it's off the wall from Alex Hellman as he rounds into second base. That's a double for the Xavier center fielder, and he's got this Xavier faithful pumped up down the first base line.
So the Musketeers starting to find some answers here. They've had a couple of looks at Peterson. Ball low in the zone. Hellman gets down there with that big frame, athletic frame, able to pump it out to the wall. Easy double there for Hellman.
Let's send it down to John Fanta, who's standing by with Ed Service, the winning coach of our first round matchup.
Thanks very much, Matt. Ed, congratulations on the dramatic 8-7 win over Seton Hall earlier today. What can you say about the way your team fought to walk it off?
Well, this is a good group of guys. They've been very resilient the entire year. We haven't had a comeback win quite like that, but I'm not totally surprised. Because it's a quality group of guys. And, it didn't look very good early, did it? But we found a way.
Will Hanifan was very emotional with us after the win, talking about how much adversity he's gone through, the injury that he had to go through. Just how special is it for you to watch him fight through things and now have his moment today, his reward?
Well, Will was a part of our, big part of our team 2 years ago, the one that went to a regional and played in a regional final. And then he kind of lost his starting position. When he got injured, he was out for 6 or 7 weeks. He lost his spot, didn't get a chance to play much. Started playing a little bit better last weekend, and we went with the hot hand, and he had a big game today. So I'm always happy for those guys. He's an upperclassman. He deserves an opportunity to play, and he took advantage of it, and he'll be out there next time we play again.
So curious, because the game of baseball has so many waves of momentum, and every time you and Seton Hall play, it seems like there are waves and waves, and you and your team have been fortunate enough to be the ones that are closing these Big East tournament games out, now 7-0 against the Pirates in a lot of thrilling finishes. When your team comes off the field, Ed, and they've given up 3 runs in the top half of the inning, what do you say to them?
Well, not much. We needed some help. And, we got it. They walked the first 3 batters to get the bases loaded with nobody out, and then we knew we had a chance. But let me just say this. Seton Hall played a heck of a game today. I thought they did a lot of things right. They clearly out-hit us. They defended well. They just had a little trouble throwing strikes. And it came back to the ninth inning. It came back to bite them a little bit. But, I was really impressed with how they played today, the energy they played with. And we've kind of had their number. And sometimes that's just the way it is. It's about matchups. And we seem to have their number, especially in tournament baseball.
How special is this stage here at Prasco Park, this atmosphere?
Well, this is a nice park. I congratulate the people who work here, who put this together. I mean, they're out there, a couple hours before the game, picking dirt off the grass, making sure it doesn't come into play. And it's a really neat place. It's very done very professionally. I've always been impressed with it. And, we seem to play pretty well here, too. So That's certainly helpful as well.
As there's a strike 3 called for out number 2, Ed Service, the Creighton baseball head coach, is our guest right now. Blue Jays are in the winner's bracket. They win a thriller today, 8-7 over Seton Hall. So, Ed, you ended up using Paul Bergstrom. You use Sikowski, Windham out of your pen. You got a pretty solid start from Tabrak. Take us through what's going through your mind. How does your pitching set up here going forward in this tournament?
We're in pretty good shape, believe it or not. We're going to bring John Sikowski back. We're going to bring Paul Bergstrom back. We're not going to bring Ryan Windham back. But we got Tommy Steyer, another bullpen piece for us that has pitched in these late inning situations. So we feel pretty good. We got Jonas Smith that'll go tomorrow. He's been able to give us 5 to 7 innings every time he goes out. So I like our situation. We didn't burn those guys today. They were all involved with the game. And I actually believe they'll pitch better tomorrow than they did today.
I want to let you know that I had a Coca-Cola here at the edge of the dugout earlier tonight.
Well, that's great. I do enjoy one, especially after a victory. It's a lot of fun.
Ed Service, the Coca-Cola master. He's the Creighton master, and they get it done today. Ed, congratulations on the victory.
Thanks a lot.
That's Ed Service, the Creighton head coach. That'll do it for the top half of the 5th inning. UConn 7, Xavier 1 as we head in the bottom of the 5th from Prasco Park. You're watching the Big East Baseball Tournament, sponsored by Jeep.
If your money is working toward the same goals, Why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances, designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go towards your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Seven to one UConn as we get set to start the bottom of the fifth here from Prasco Park. It is Reggie Crawford leading things off for the Huskies against Dorsey Chatham, who came in to relieve for the starter Nick Zwock last inning. And the first pitch is upstairs to the lefty, Reggie Crawford. UConn comfortably in the driver's seat. They can hang on here. They'll have a date with defending champ Creighton tomorrow afternoon as Crawford looks at the first strike of the at-bat. And, Mike, I thought it was interesting. We did see Ed Service use three arms out of the bullpen, but he feels like they didn't burn the bullpen, and he's going to have two of the three coming back either tomorrow or Saturday.
No, it's great that he's got the confidence in the bullpen. So Bergstrom went an inning and a third, Sikowski an inning and a third, Windham an inning. So none of them were really stretched out in that start after DeBrock came up with a five and a third performance. You know, the hit total for Seton Hall, kind of a concern, 18, seven runs. So you wonder how that's going to play out. It was five hits for Sikowski, two apiece for Bergstrom and Windham. But some of those hits for Seton Hall weren't really all that well struck. There were a couple bleeders in there.
Scorcher right off the heel of the second baseman's glove, Jared Cushing. And in the right field, a grown man ground ball from Reggie Crawford.
Yeah, the ground balls are starting to leave marks now on the dirt and on the players. UConn continues just to make some fantastically solid contact here in this ballgame.
Great story about Reggie Crawford, guys. I was talking with Jim Penders, UConn head coach, earlier this season, and he said that early on in Reggie's career, Jim would be going down to the hotel gym, wherever they were, on the road. And he said, Reggie Crawford is the first guy that he can remember that was beating him to the hotel gym on a given morning. You know, Jim would go down around quarter to seven in that range. Reggie Crawford would already be down there halfway through his workout. You see how built he is. You just don't get that built off chance.
No, sir. You're absolutely right. And I'm not shocked that he's the first guy in the weight room for the UConn Huskies because he is a beast. And he's a sophomore.
Yeah, they call him the secret weapon, and he actually started his athletic career as a swimmer. So wow. Think about that, the fluidity that you've got to have to get through the water, and you're bringing all that athleticism now over to baseball. Other part of that, he can throw 98 miles an hour as a pitcher. We haven't seen
freestyle.
That yet.
Great athlete. And Jim Penders talked to that, Mike, saying that, you know, this is really the first time in his career that baseball has been the only sport he's focused on. And this is really his first full season of baseball, just focusing on one sport. And my goodness, that's scary for the league and for baseball as a whole going forward, because we know Reggie Crawford will eventually be a high draft pick in the Major League Baseball draft.
It's amazing how that athleticism just translates. And Matt, you know who else was a pretty good multi-sport athlete and played baseball? There's a guy named Bo Jackson.
Yeah, he was pretty good.
He went and played in the NFL a little bit too.
He was
Deion Sanders, multiple sports.
He was pretty good.
Charlie Ward comes to mind, another good baseball player for Florida State. See, I wonder if Reggie Crawford's getting some calls from the UConn football office.
You know who else is playing pretty well? David Langer.
Yes.
Doubled, homered, and has scored twice in this game.
And the home run was so impressive. Just what looked like was going to be a routine fly ball carried all the way over about the 340, 350 mark out there.
High hopper to third. Deep in the hole is Olsen across the diamond, and it pulls Franzoni off the bag. An infield single for Langer. And Crawford is up to second. And now two on and nobody out for UConn here in the bottom of the fifth.
Well, that was a high chopper behind the bag, and Olsen had to respect some speed there from Langer. You see him have to gather up around his chest and to make a quick decision whether to throw that or not. He pulls Franzoni off the bag, and nice job by Franzoni over there to keep that from a throwing error that would have added some bases and moved it to a second and third situation.
So now here's Chris Brown. Doubled and drove in two back in the second. And he's dropping down a bunt up the third baseline. Olsen charging in and almost beat out the throw, but does his job moving both runners over. And now Crawford stands 90 feet away at third base.
Well, Matt, UConn just keeping the line moving. And that's one of those plays in this situation. Sure, you want to move the runner, but that's sending a message down the line. Ed Service is here. He's going to play him tomorrow. That's planting a seed in Ed Service's mind. And, hey, in that situation, UConn can lay down the bunt. So that can cause all kinds of ripple effect down the line in this tournament.
And now here comes Brian Furlong. And he has pointed to the Xavier bullpen. So we'll have a pitching change. That's all for Dorsey Chatham. Gives up the rock with one out in the bottom of the fifth and two on. UConn leading 7-1 and threatening to pad their lead. We'll be right back from Prasco Park after this.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Griffin Lanoue relieving Dorsey Chatham and making his 10th appearance of the season out of the bullpen for just the seventh time this year. He's tossed 12 innings for the Musketeers. And he's got a tough situation here, Mike. One down and two on against Zach Buechling, who has now faced three different pitchers tonight for Xavier, and he has reached in the previous two plate appearances.
Not a shocker there with eight hits for the Connecticut Huskies, but Griffin Lanoue, a senior. So we've seen Billy O'Connor go to his freshman, give him an opportunity. Now Griffin Lanoue, one of your veterans, competed in this tournament before. More of a guy that pitches to contact. His best season so far with the Musketeers was 2019. The ERA was 6.75. He started 10 times, appeared 13 times that season, went 45 in the third inning. So a guy that can eat up some innings, 102 for his career, but a pitch-to-contact guy, 131 hits against him in those innings.
Awesome. Matt, Mike, here's the question that I pose from the dugout right now. you realize you're in the now, but there's two sides to managing in the now and managing for this tournament and realizing that Creighton and Seton Hall have just been in a marathon game. I'm just curious, in a 7-1 game, if you're Xavier, what do you guys think is the approach from here, knowing that it's 7-1, there's two runners on, and that if you do lose this game, you're not dead?
Well, John, I think we've seen it here with the two moves that Billy O'Connor made out of the bullpen. And if he was trying to win this game or really go after it, and he talked about it yesterday, if he had an opportunity, would use Ethan Bosacker, Lane Flam, maybe even Trevor Olson, who's got a 3.16 ERA for the Musketeers. If he was going for it here, we would have seen one of those two pitchers or one of those three in this ballgame.
Yeah, I agree, and I think that's a great question, John, because this is a four-day tournament. You've got to win three games at least. If you lose the first game, though, you've got to win four.
In a row.
So, you know, Billy O'Connor, I'm sure, has that in the back of his mind. You know, relief pitching has not been the strength of this Xavier program this season. And to Mike's point, if this was a tighter game, we may be seeing a call to the bullpen and using his third starter. But instead, he's gone deep, deep, deep down the bullpen roster. Here's the 0-2, and Lanoue gets a strikeout of Bushling, two away.
So here's a veteran coming in and producing for the Musketeers. But the first thing when we asked Billy O'Connor about his bullpen, he kind of smiled a little bit, looked up in the sky, said, yeah, we got some guys we trust. Trey Schramm was one of those names. Haven't seen him yet. But there wasn't really that power go-to guy in there. He said Dorsey Chatham might get a shot. He did. Griffin Lanoue, a veteran.
Well, and it's not like he said we don't have the talent in the bullpen.
Right.
They've got the arms. They just haven't seen consistency with the same arms game after game. Back to the top of the order, here's Kyler Fedko. Man, he takes a first pitch strike.
Yeah, for the Musketeers, Michael Dillons had a pretty good year, a 3.5 ERA. We talked about Trey Stamm, Jared Gadd, another guy that could throw some heat. So the Musketeers played a four-game series with Georgetown and added a fifth, and it turned into a bullpen day. And some of the younger arms that came out of that bullpen for the Musketeers were in the middle 90s. Just the control wasn't quite there yet.
So Fedko takes two strikes on the outside corner. Two on, two out, a six-run lead for the number one seed in the tournament, the UConn Huskies, who come in with a top 25 RPI. And probably on the bubble as an at-large bid if they were not to win this tournament.
Well, the flip side of that, and you talk about UConn coming into the league and making it better, if somebody can knock them off, now this becomes a two-bid league.
I think, Mike, and I'm curious what you think, I do think even if UConn, say, got to the championship game and lost, say, in seven for that if necessary game, they would make the NCAA tournament field.
Yeah, I agree. And you know, that RPI number really speaks volumes. And the fact that they were able to finish the season the way they did, kind of come back the way they did, and just show these types of performances. There's another RBI.
Fedko up the middle. That'll drive two. Across home plate, it's a 9-1 lead for UConn, and Fedko's first RBIs of his Big East tournament career.
So runs in every inning now for the UConn Huskies. One run in the first and the third, then multiple runs, and still counting here as we get moving. And this ball hit well enough up the middle. Chopper got past Cushing and Housinger. Cushing shaded over a little towards center field. Didn't get there in time. And Matt, the way you look at UConn, the way they can manufacture runs, how do you keep them out of an NCAA opportunity?
Climbing the ladder, Lanoue gets the tapper back to the rubber and tosses to first to end the inning. Kyler Fetko gets involved in the scoring. It's a 9-1 lead for UConn, who has scored at least a run in each of the first five innings.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix. Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway.
Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose
Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints, collectively shaping and forever changing. What makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
Top of the sixth inning here from Prasco Park. It's a 9-1 lead for the UConn Huskies, and still Austin Peterson on the mound and in control for the number one seed in the Big East tournament. Let's send it back down on the field with John Fanto.
Thank you, man. Mike, it is terrific to be joined by the man overseeing the Big East Baseball Championship. He is part of the lifeblood of the Big East Conference, especially in a spring like this one where there's championships week in and week out. This is the last championship of the year. We welcome in the director of all things Big East baseball, James Green. James, thanks for taking the time tonight.
Thanks, John. Appreciate it. Happy to be here.
James, we'll start with this. These student-athletes on the diamond, the student-athletes that you see throughout your sports, whether it be men's lacrosse, tennis, field hockey, and the other sports that you cover, what are your thoughts on these kids, the administrators, people you work with day in and day out, of what this year's been like, and what can you say about the way everybody's tried to handle things day by day?
Well, in terms of the way the year went, I hope we never have to live through another year like this, but I think it's shown how tenacious our student athletes are in the Big East. Our administrators did an amazing job on campus. You know, we've heard things here, just people talking about a great job that the Big East has done to get championships off the ground this spring. With everything being pushed into the spring, the fall sports, the soccers, the volleyballs, overlapping with what we did with baseball and softball and swimming and diving and everything into such a tight window here, basically from March and April and May. But really, it's the boots on the ground on campus, from the athletes to the coaches, the athletic trainers, the team doctors. It was really a group effort, and I think everybody showed their moxie these last 9 months for sure.
Big East Baseball Tournament is here at Prasco Park for a third year. What are your thoughts on the people that you work with here and the atmosphere that this venue continues to provide?
It's tremendous. I mean, they have welcomed us with open arms, obviously. They do a great job here. It's a tremendous, tremendous staff here. Patrick O'Donnell, the Arrington family, we're so grateful to be here, especially this year, above all else, as a capstone to such a tough year for all of our student athletes and all of our baseball teams, to be able to provide this atmosphere for them with a crowd that we have here tonight, with the COVID parameters and the protocols kind of loosening up just in time here in Ohio for us to have the capacity that we can have here. But they do such an amazing job, and the teams really feel welcome here. It's a great experience for these teams and their coaches and the athletes, and it's just it's an event that we really look forward to when we get to this point of the year.
James, Mike Schmaltz, just talk a little bit about how Prasco does a lot of it on its own to make this event very successful in a very nice environment. And just one thing, compliments to you on your announcing talent choices for day one. We'll get that into.
We do what we can for you, Schmaltz. What can I say? I think, again, that the Prasco folks here, they really have made an investment in baseball in a number of different facets, obviously. It's really part of what they do here. They feel that it's part of what they do and you know, basically their mission statement here, and it's great to be here. We feel so welcomed here. All of our teams feel so welcomed.
And they have so much space for us to be able to use. We've got the AstroTurf or the artificial surface next door that we can use for practices and BP on game days, so we can keep the grass field here in really good shape for the game. So, I mean, they just have so much here that they can do for us, and pretty much everything we ask, they're able to help us out with it. It's just tremendous to be here. It really feels like a home for us.
So you had a little bit of a contract extension, I think maybe 2 years ago, and with last year being canceled, how would that affect what the future might look here for the tournament?
Yeah, so we're officially here through 22, which is obviously next year. So we haven't had conversations yet about what we're going to do for 23. I think, you know, in the spirit of partnership, there might be some mutual interest in tacking on another year onto that. But, you know, we have to have that conversation first. Really, our focus here this week is to just take it day by day, get through this tournament. In light of what we've done and what we've seen with everything going on with the pandemic, it's really one day at a time, and that's really been our focus here. So when the time comes, we'll have those conversations.
Nobody out and a runner at first base now for the lefty, Andrew Walker. It's a 9-1 lead for UConn. And Walker looks at a ball upstairs. James, Matt Schumacher, you know, we've talked to so many people over the years who come out to this park, not only the student athletes, but coaches and fans alike, and even the scouts who, you know, they spend a lot of time in ballparks all across the country at the professional level. But everyone says the same thing about Prasco and this tournament. It's so fun. It's got a magical feel to it. As a guy who's seen a lot of tournament baseball, what's your favorite aspect of Big East Tournament weekend?
I just like the fact that we can get four teams together and get everybody together, especially in this atmosphere here. It's so family friendly, so family oriented, and the park is so intimate. You know, I mean, you can stand, I'm standing 6 feet away from the batter who's on the on deck circle. So you get really close to the action here, and that's one of the things I really like about Prasco, is just the experience, the intimacy. But I like this tournament in general. I grew up playing baseball. I love baseball. I was a first baseman. You could probably tell from my build. Wasn't very fast.
Power hitter.
Yeah, I was a dead pull hitter to right field. It was basically all or nothing, you know. If I played now and had anything, they'd be putting the shift on me, and I'd be hitting about 150. But, you know, I grew up playing baseball. This tournament's pretty close to my heart just because I just have that affinity for the sport, because that's what I grew up playing.
Guys, is Joe Cruz off to get some barbecue sauce right now?
Yeah, they're back.
We got a replay review, but James Green, we appreciate the time. The aspect that I miss most is that barbecue sauce. It was like a 2-year wait to get some Montgomery in tonight, and it was worth it.
John, happy to be on with you, and I just have to say I'm excited that UConn's in the league because we have another coach that goes to my barber. So we have the same. I'm really super excited about that.
Thank you, James.
Thanks, guys. Thank you, James Green. Thank you, John. The umpiring crew is now looking at that bang-bang play at second base. It was Christian Fedko bobbling as he was kind of ranging to his right, tried to flip it to the shortstop, Zach Buechling. The call on the field is that the runner, Jack Housinger, is safe at second base. And if he is safe, that means two on and nobody out for Natale Manastra. And that's, even in an 8-run game, maybe a dangerous opportunity for the Xavier Musketeers to make this interesting here midway through.
Well, we saw what happened last time. Manastra was up, doubled out to the gap. So a veteran hitter, just the guy you want in this spot. And while it's 9-1, if you can pick up a couple of runs here with nobody out. We mentioned hitting contagious. Xavier's put together some big innings in this season. No time better than the present to start that. Matt, I'm not much of a mathlete, but 9-3 gets you a third of the way there.
That's right. Well, hey, look, John Fanta talked about this. No lead is safe in this tournament. You know, maybe if we get into double digits in the last few innings, then we're talking about a safe lead, and particularly in the first round, maybe a team just decides, you know what, we're going to pack it in, so to speak, and get ready for day two in the must-win elimination game. But at this point, in the sixth inning, you know, you've got an opportunity here, Mike, with some of your hottest hitters in the lineup for Xavier coming up, nobody out, potentially two on. Things could get interesting here against a UConn team that, to this point, has just dominated this game.
And we really haven't seen Austin Peterson get into any trouble yet tonight.
No, not at all. And here's a review that, you know, Billy O'Connor's given his team every chance it can to get back into this game. So sure, go over and review that. You get a little bit of a rest. Natalie Minostra gets to look at Austin Peterson warm up a little bit more.
And the official call is that the safe call on second base will stand. Not enough to overturn the call on the field. And now Natalie Minostra, who doubled his last time up against Austin Peterson, will come to the dish with two on and nobody out. And the Musketeers trailing by eight here in the top of the sixth.
I don't know if you noticed, but 45, I believe, in the bullpen.
So big chance here for Natalie Minostra. Leader for this team. Done so much for the program. See if he can knock a couple of runs in here. Peterson continues to fire away.
Well, Minostra did have 30 runs batted in, five homers, and hit close to 300 during the course of the regular season. As he takes a strike on the 1-0. Got on base more than 40% of the time and drew the second most walks in the Big East with 18, behind only teammate Jack Housinger, who drew a walk to start off the inning. So perhaps some good juju here to start the sixth for the Musketeers. The 1-1 almost caught Minostra, 2-1.
And the other interesting part about that is Minostra's the catcher, right? So he's going to know probably how UConn wants to approach him, because that's his job. He's got to decipher hitters and how they want to pitch the UConn lineup. So we'll have a pretty good idea what's coming in here, especially his third time through.
75 pitches tonight now for Peterson. And his 2-1 comes home to Minostra.
So the mature at bat, he's ahead 2-1. Gets a pitch that might be close, fouls it off.
Just a guy who battles in his fifth season at Xavier, ultimate leader, earned Big East All-First Team this year for the first time in his career after garnering second team honors back in 2019. And the thing Billy O'Connor said that he's most impressed with by Natalie Minostra is just the way he sets an example for the rest of the program. From seniors on down to freshmen, he epitomizes what it should look like to be a Xavier baseball player. Oh, goes down with a big cut on strikes, one away, and the fifth strikeout of the night for Austin Peterson.
So Peterson battles right back in a tough situation. What's that, Matt? 76 pitches, so how efficient has he been?
Tremendous.
Little breaking ball coming in there high on the hands. Minostra couldn't get around on it.
Now the righty, Jared Cushing. Cushing tonight 1-for-2 with a double back in the fourth, which scored Natalie Minostra. The lone run for Xavier to this point. Take advantage of 2-1, then 1 out here in the sixth. And a big 12-6 breaking ball from Peterson makes it 1-1. That's looking sharper and sharper as the night goes on.
And there's the other half of the equation for UConn. We talk about the offense here, 9 runs, 9 hits. But now you got a pitching staff that kind of getting better as the game goes on, picking up confidence. And a chance, too, for Peterson maybe to work on some things. If he doesn't feel like his breaking pitch is where he wants it to be, he can try it out in some of these situations. You got a little room to play around. You don't want to go throwing the Ephus pitch or the and let Xavier back into it, but a chance to maybe experiment a little.
Working on his sixth strikeout of the night. This is upstairs. UConn does have some action in the bullpen. Down the left field line.
So we've seen Peterson get up in the zone quite a bit. One of those guys right there, that is Kenneth House. And Kenneth House, in the first series against the Musketeers, worked three innings, struck out nine.
There's another strikeout. It's the sixth of the night for Austin Peterson on a nasty breaking ball in the dirt. Two gone.
So Peterson battling right back out of trouble. First and second, nobody out. He comes back with two strikeouts. And here's the thing for Jim Penders. You really don't have to save Austin Peterson for anything. You can ride him out. I know they're thinking complete game. Still scattered seven hits here, but just one run.
Two gone, two on for Tyler DeMartino. In the dirt, gets away from Winkle, but he quickly corrals and keeps all runners at bay.
Great play again by Winkle. We've seen him jump out a couple of times to hold the Xavier runners to their bases. No reason for Xavier to try to risk that and run themselves right out of the inning.
It might be auto. Yeah, there's a button right above it, I believe.
Winkle expected to be a top five round draft pick later on this summer in the Major League Baseball draft. It's a guy who, if you talk to UConn head coach Jim Penders, he said, you know, the biggest thing he's developed over the course of his career is toughness. And it's not that he wasn't tough when he came in, but, you know, he was having to catch every game for 5 weeks straight this season due to injuries and to COVID. It kind of wrecked their catching depth. As the 2-0 misses outside, and now a 3-0 count to Tyler DeMartino. They didn't have another healthy catcher on the roster for a five-week stretch, and Pat Winkle, who had Tommy John surgery last season, really developed strength in his arm, strength in his legs, and it ended up being a really good thing that they lacked depth, particularly for Pat Winkle.
Yeah, he said he's throwing much better in the second half of the season. The other point he made was, you know, highly recruited out of high school. He comes from those travel programs and those RBI programs, et cetera. And the catchers really only get three or four innings because they're trying to showcase the talent for the next level. So for him to come and catch nine-inning games three, four times a week was really an accomplishment.
Three ball, one strike count to DeMartino, two on and two out. Fouled back to run the count full. Does a great job of handling the pitching staff here at UConn. And you know, he's a guy who came to UConn in spite of an offer from Vanderbilt, who, of course, has been a perennial power, not just in the Southeastern Conference, but across the country, winning the College World Series just a couple of years ago. But his brother, Chris Winkle, who's a fifth-year grad student for the Huskies, convinced him to come, and it's worked out pretty well for the two of them. A walk to load the bases with two outs, and it gives way to Alex Hellman.
So Hellman tonight a double, grounded into a double play his last time. But this is a moment that Alex Hellman has somewhat excelled in here this season. He's had the timely hits. So a double already off of Peterson tonight. Can he find a little magic here for the Musketeers?
So the base is juiced for Alex Hellman, who did homer off of Peterson back in April during the four-game regular season series, which the Musketeers and the Huskies split 2-2.
Yeah, he's hit five home runs this season. And Matt will test my math skills once again. One plus four equals five, so that gets you to four. But Billy O'Connor was talking about Hellman and putting on weight, and some of those warning track shots that he was able to hit during the season, they want to see him maybe put on 20 more pounds, and some of those will start going out.
Hellman into shallow right in a basket catch, hugging the line for Reggie Crawford. So
Two on and nobody out. Bases loaded, two outs. Xavier unable to capitalize. Peterson gets out of the jam, and it's an eight-run lead for the Huskies.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Back from the ballpark and some stoic faces for the Xavier Musketeer fans. I think everybody was expecting maybe a closer game here on night one, but credit to UConn and the play of their starting pitcher, Austin Peterson. It's a 9-1 lead and a leadoff single to start the bottom of the sixth for Eric Stock. It's his third time aboard tonight.
They just keep hitting the contact, Matt. Hit the ball where it's pitched. Do what you can with it. Sign of a disciplined hitting team. Hit number 10. And a runner on with nobody out. And a chance yet again to score with Pat Winkle coming up. Xavier, I think yesterday when talking with Billy O'Connor, was certainly optimistic about its chances here in this ball game. They've been able to hit with UConn, just three less hits than the Huskies. Just him to push runs across. Musketeers have left six. The Huskies, Matt, have left five. So something still on the table here for UConn.
And I think, you know, there's something to be said, too, for the psychology of this game. Mike, UConn just jumped out early. It was a four-run lead after two innings. They played at three in a huge second inning, which included three straight doubles. And here's one ripped into center field, and it bounces off the mitt of Alex Hellman. Back-to-back base hits to open up the sixth. And I think, at least from my perspective, it was like, whoa. Okay, UConn came to play. They brought the bats. Peterson's backing them up on the mound. And it's continuing here into the sixth.
Just another solid swing. A little top spin on that. Got Hellman on a short hop. But they're really continuing to make contact. And I think the other part of that was this Xavier team was one that pushed UConn in that series a couple of weeks ago back at Xavier. So to come in here and make that authoritative statement, you're up 9-1. And we're in the bottom of the sixth. It's got to be a pretty good feeling for the Huskies.
Back in the conference for the first time since 2013. Trying to pick up right where they left off. Of course, they won the conference in 2013. Here's a fly ball into right field. Caught by Hellman, but the runner Stock will tag from second to third. Good heads-up base running from Eric Stock, who's had a nice night. He's been on board three times and driven in a run.
Check out Hellman here. Makes the catch clean and then trying to fire maybe over to third. Lost his footing. Now we get a conference. And I hope we don't get a review on that one.
Are they reviewing whether or not he caught, whether he maintained control of the baseball when he went down?
I don't think there's any question of that. Either.
Or are they reviewing whether or not the runner left early?
That's probably a better option.
Either way, we're getting another trip over to the tent.
Especially because they were talking with Billy O'Connor, so you have to think that they're going to challenge that Stock left early. Now I'll agree with you here. Maybe that one in a 9-1 situation you don't want to review. Yes, John.
I've stepped into the booth for this one.
Bring it on.
You heard my rant earlier today about
I did.
Video review.
And at that time, much closer game, okay?
Am I in the judges' chambers right now?
You are, not necessarily. We are in a bantering situation. We're in an exchange of ideas, an idea thought tank, if you will.
Well, I'm just telling you right now, I just think that video review is supposed to enhance the game. And in that instance, even earlier today, you can argue that it is enhancing the game. We're tied at 4 between Creighton and Seton Hall. There's a lot on the line. You want to make sure you get it right. We get it. In a 9-1 game, postseason or not, that looked pretty obvious in live action. And my biggest thing with this is, the video review element, is that I look at the pitcher. A pitcher is supposed to be in control of a game. And it's actually almost given that right, Mike? That he's on the mound, he's supposed to be the one in control. He's allowed that. He's going at his tempo. I do think sometimes the review is done to potentially either throw off a pitcher or break up the flow, and that's where I do question the integrity, the pace of baseball itself.
No, I agree with you there, and I agree with you situationally. And, again, if it's a Tuesday night in March, that's not a good review. But in this situation, in some of these tighter games, now not necessarily this one, I don't know that that was the best time to challenge. I mean, 9-1, you still got a couple of shots at a pitcher who's you got 7 hits off of, you just haven't been able to score. But again, elimination, you're trying to extend your season, you're trying to get as much out of this as you can, and that's why you can use it here a little bit more effectively than you would in a regular season. So that's why I'm a little bit more for it, not necessarily this situation.
So we have a settlement here for now.
We do. I think that's good arbitration.
Perfect.
Solid?
I like that.
You want to sign it?
Yeah.
Sign the box score?
I'll sign the dotted line.
There it is. John Fanta will sign the lineup sheet. And I'll join you. I'll put it right here on the left side. This could be one of those collector's items that some people.
All right. I'm going to go grab some ice cream.
Want later on in life.
You guys want some?
Spirited debate here on the BEDN.
Well, the call on the field stands. Reggie Crawford digs in with runners at first and third, one out. Fanta's off to have his first ice cream cone of the weekend. Of course, everything here is free, and I got to say, the ice cream is pretty darn good.
Oh, it's they don't cheat you here at all. I mean, it's all quality stuff.
No, they don't. Handcuffed, high pop up into shallow center. Will the runner tag? Stock is headed towards home. Here comes the throw from Hellman, and it's cut off. The 10th run of the ball game coming across for the Huskies, and now Crawford's been involved in 3 scoring plays tonight. For the Huskies, it's a 10-1 lead for the number one seed in the tournament.
And they've scored again in every inning, so they push over another. 10-1 now. If you're thinking the 10-run rule, that is not in effect here for the championship, nor is the extra runner on base and extra innings for the championship. So pure baseball, Matt, here for the title.
Just like the way the founding baseball fathers intended it, right?
What John was just talking about, pace of play, and, you know, I only saw it once. Calling some Musketeer games this year where the extra runner came into effect. And it did actually, in the end of a 4-game series, it did actually move it on and probably save some arms, pitching-wise.
And I think at the collegiate level particularly. Now, you know, if we're talking Major League Baseball, I totally get it from a pace of play standpoint.
Sure?
I am a big proponent of speeding up the game.
Yeah.
particularly to appeal to the younger players and fans. From a collegiate level, you're absolutely right. It saves some arms.
Right.
And I almost wonder, would it be valuable in this tournament for that exact reason?
It could be.
For a team like, yeah, like Xavier, for example. Here's a shot in the right field. That drops for a two-out single. And David Langer has reached base in all four times he's come to the plate today for UConn.
Or Creighton, which likes to use its bullpen.
Langer's a triple away from the cycle.
Man, he is just muscling balls to the outfield. That one was a diving line drive, so that one he didn't get under as much as the home run, but both of them went to right field. He just takes a big swing and connects.
Well, we've got another call to the bullpen brought to you by SoFi. This is the Big East Baseball Tournament presented by Jeep. It's a 10-1 lead for UConn in the sixth. We'll be back in just a moment.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix, Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway.
Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now?
And now.
I am.
I am.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints collectively shaping and forever changing what makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
Xander Rojan comes out from the bullpen. He is the fourth arm used tonight for Billy O'Connor and company. And he comes in with his team trailing by nine. A runner on and two outs. Make that two on and two out. And he'll take on Chris Brown, who's doubled and driven in two so far tonight.
Rojan, one of those young arms, a sophomore from Elk Grove, Illinois. They're That's trying to work into the mix for the future. Right. Trey Schramm's going to be gone from the program. Griffin Lanoue, you just saw, going to be gone from the program. So somebody's going to have to step up here in relief roles for the Musketeers. And Rojan's going to get a great chance here against one of the best teams in the country. Chance to get a put out here in an interesting situation. First and second, two down, and you're down nine.
Brown holds back on a breaking ball low and away, 1-0.
Rojan in high school at a 1.6 ERA, 202 strikeouts in 140 innings for Elk Grove. And a chance to see if that experience can translate here. He's got a 1-1 count.
In the dirt, and it gets all the way to the backstop. Both runners advance. So now Pat Winkle over at third, Langer at second, and a 2-1 count to Chris Brown. UConn, should they hang on, we'll get a date with the reigning Big East Tournament champion, Creighton Blue Jays. Tomorrow afternoon here at Prasco Park. Of course, some weather expected to hit us tomorrow, which will perhaps throw some twists into the plans.
It'll be interesting to see what Jim Penders does here. So you're up nine. Your offense is clicking pretty well on every level. You want to try to get some folks into this game and maybe risk disrupting your offensive rhythm, or you want to just keep your front line guys in here and hammer one out?
That is a great question. I'm almost inclined to say leave them in. Keep with the flow. You know what I mean? Your team is playing so well right now, particularly offensively. Don't take the bat out of their hands. Let them get the reps at the plate if it keeps going around the order.
Especially now if you have a chance that you might not play tomorrow at all.
Right, right. Here's the lefty, Zach Buechling, facing his fourth different pitcher of the night. Lucky him.
It's amazing. Well, he's reached two out of the three times, double last time. Struck out against the starter's walk.
The outfield plays the lefty straight up. A long look in from Xander Rojan. Now he's set for the 1-0. And the dirt picked out well by Manastro.
Looks like Rojan's bringing a pretty good fastball. We don't have the luxury of the radar reading up there on the scoreboard. We were talking a little bit earlier about some of these young Xavier arms that really can bring some power, just haven't had the experience or the opportunities to work on the control in live settings.
Well, Billy O'Connor really does have a pretty young team, and he's super excited about the class that's coming in. Didn't get into too many details, but he's pumped for a couple of transfers that will be coming to Xavier next year, in addition to some high school seniors that will be making their way to Cincinnati. As the 3-0 is right down the pipe for strike one. Bases loaded for Buechling, two down. And of course, this Xavier team, Mike, you know, they've won more Big East tournament championships than any other team since realignment. 3, 14, 16, and 17. And O'Connor was part of all three of those as an assistant on the staff. Rojan will walk in a run as Buechling heads up to first. It's now an 11-1 lead for UConn.
They've always seemed to find a way here to come back from a little bit of adversity. Certainly 11-1 here. It's not looking like it's going to go their direction. So they're going to let Rojan work his way out of this situation. He just needs one more out. You talk about Billy O'Connor being just excited about his team, but he's just excited about baseball in general. Just loves the game. We heard from Adam Baum a little bit earlier about the connection with his mother and how baseball's always been the fabric of his life. He's just an excitable guy. You can see him light up when he starts talking about different situations and how they coached, and that's true with a lot of the coaches here in this tournament, but Billy O'Connor just brings a unique energy at times.
Visit to the mound from Natalie Manastra.
And there's the element of Natalie Manastra's game. We asked Nick Zwack about that relationship, and he said, you know, Natalie's always great with settling me down, and asked him if he had a particular situation he could recall this year. He said, yeah, you know, Natalie came out one time, started like five different sentences, didn't finish any of them, gave me a pat on the back, and went back behind the plate.
Said they had a good laugh about it after the game.
Yeah, a little Bull Durham effect.
Wasn't sure what he said in the moment.
Right. But it worked.
It worked. And when you've been with a guy
stress relief
that long, Mike, they've been battery mates for 5 years.
Right. It's almost like you don't have to finish the sentence.
That's right.
Like a good marriage.
Here is Kyler Fedko. Lifts the 2-0 down the right field line. Trailing towards the line is Schultz, and he'll make the play to end the inning. Another two-run inning for UConn. They have scored in all six innings at the plate tonight. They lead it by 10 as we head to the seventh in Mason, Ohio.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances, designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go towards your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Big East call to the bullpen brought to you by SoFi. Austin Peterson, an excellent night. Just one run allowed on seven hits, and he struck out six. And he gives way for the big, burly left-hander, Garrett Coe, 6'6", 276, Mike Schmaltz.
And he's from a high school called The Gunnery. So why wouldn't you recruit a pitcher from a high school with that name? And let's maybe have a little secondary sponsor here on the call to the bullpen for the WWE, because this is one mountain of a pitcher. We were standing there yesterday. We talked about Reggie Crawford. And right next to him was Garrett Coe. Just impressive physically. We don't know what his fastball here could touch, but I'm going to bet it's a lot.
Well, and this is only his first season in uniform for UConn. In spite of being with the program last year, he was not on the 35-man roster.
And not only that, Matt, but he brings a 1.35 ERA into this one. This is his seventh appearance. He's only worked 6 2/3, but in those, struck out seven, walked just five.
It just goes to show you how deep this bullpen goes for UConn. The fact that this guy who's tossed a sub-2 ERA is only making his seventh appearance
of
the season.
Exactly.
And he's only pitched in three Big East games. Went 2/3 of an inning against Xavier. Walked two. Didn't allow any runs, though, and got out of the inning. Two innings against St. John's, two against Seton Hall. He's only allowed one earned run, Mike, in 6 2/3.
We were talking about guys you want to get off the bus first and make sure your opponents see. That's my guy right there.
That'll set the tone.
In
six,
any sport.
6'6", 276. He could play
tight end. If it's a football team, let's do it.
Coe just misses off the inside part of the plate, taking on Garrett Schultz, who's worked the count 3-0.
That's a good test here for Coe as well against a Musketeer lineup. Garrett Schultz, pretty good hitter, 228, disciplined guy at the plate. He's worked a 3-1 count here. Then Olson, then he's going to get the top of the lineup with Franzoni and Hausinger.
Pitching in his first collegiate postseason tournament. Of course, UConn finishing runners-up in the American Conference each of the last two seasons, minus the 2020 year, which, of course, was shortened due to COVID-19. There was no baseball postseason. Here's the 3-2. And that is low, a leadoff walk for Garrett Schultz, his first time aboard tonight.
And one of those runner-up finishes for the Huskies has a little bit of a Cincinnati connection. It was the Cincinnati Bearcats that took them out of the tournament. And just a team that year at Cincinnati that got hot at the right time. They were struggling hitting and somehow got to Clearwater, Florida, and started launching balls over the wall with extreme regularity and consistency. And that team, coached by Scott Goomis, the former Xavier head coach.
You're on college baseball long enough, you can start to connect many dots.
Absolutely.
Kind of one of those sports where there are maybe less than 3 degrees of separation between each team across the country.
And just the longevity that you see with some of these college coaches, even here in the Big East. I mean, Jim Pender's been around forever at Service with his great tradition, his family tradition. Coach Shepard at Seton Hall, that great family tradition. So the ties run really deep.
In that first game earlier today, there were a combined 36 years of head coaching experience at
that school between Shepherd and Ed Service, both with their programs for 18 seasons.
Good strikeout there on a breaking pitch. So Cole gets on the board with a strikeout. Now he gets a power hitter in Luke Franzoni. The high fastball swung through.
Franzoni tonight, 1-for-3. He doubled off of Peterson back in the third. Peterson in line for his 7th win of the season. Hard hit to third. Brown on to second. The throw over to first. Crawford stretching, but he came off the bag. So no double play ball to end the inning. Franzoni keeps it alive now for Jack Housinger.
One of the rare miscues we've seen tonight for the Huskies. Nevertheless, Coe's got to feel pretty good about that. Getting a ground ball against the leadoff hitter for the Musketeers. Good contact guy.
I'll tell you what, for all the talk about Reggie Crawford and his offensive prowess, he's made some really good plays over at first tonight.
It's just natural athleticism, Matt. Something I've never experienced.
Me neither, to that extent.
Well, now you were a track guy, Butler.
Yeah,
so let's give you that.
If I stand next to Reggie Crawford, there is a, shall we say, a significant difference.
Well, you don't know what he's going to feel about you standing over there. I mean, you got a presence and an aura. Never underestimate your competition, Matt.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Here is Housinger, 1-1 count to the lefty. Walked his last time up. Put together a really nice season for the Musketeers. And he's a guy who's moved up in the lineup as well. Hit 304 during the regular season, 25 runs batted in, 14 doubles. He is an extra base hit machine. And he got on base nearly 45% of the time.
Yeah, very good contact hitter. And Billy O'Connor was talking about yesterday with Ryan Altenberger not available, that they've had to move some things around. He says, you move some things around, you try it, see what sticks.
It's really too bad we're not seeing Ryan Altenberger in this
right.
tournament. I mean, he's been out since April 26th, though Xavier was pretty certain he wouldn't be available for this tournament regardless. However, he was, for the 18 games that he played, perhaps the best hitter in the lineup.
Absolutely.
He
talked about that series.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, you put so much energy into that, you felt like a wet dish rag emotionally and physically. Because then you take inventory and you realize, hey, we just lost 3 of our 4 starting infielders,
right.
And Altenberger was one of them. And he got hit in the ribcage and played the next game. And then they figured out that it was a little more serious than that.
Infield single for Housinger keeps the inning alive. Franzoni up to second. And now Andrew Walker will come to the plate. It's funny, you know, talking about that Xavier-UConn series back in April, there was a good chance that wasn't going to happen if it wasn't for Billy O'Connor,
right.
You know, really catering to Jim Penders and saying, listen, we can move the series back so that you guys can get here. And Billy O'Connor wanted to win all 4 games. Penders said, look, he wasn't just being nice. He thought he could beat us 4 games in a row, and he took 2 of the 4. But it was interesting listening to how competitive that series was in April. After a 2-week break for UConn due to COVID-19.
So it was a doubleheader on Sunday. Xavier took the first one. That was Locke's big performance, 5-0. UConn takes the second, 8-5. The third one was the amazing game. It ended tied at 13. They had to suspend it for darkness on a Monday. Came back Tuesday morning at 10:30, completed that game, which UConn won 15-13 and 12, and then Xavier won the finale 6-5 that same day. So Jim Penders was, when was the last time, you know, 2 games officially were played in the Big East on a Tuesday? But a lot of respect going both ways between Billy O'Connor and Jim Penders. That's got to feel good for Billy O'Connor, too. They didn't really know each other.
Mm.
I know that Jim Pender's new Scott Coogans, who of course the predecessor to Billy O'Connor in the same system. He goes, Jim Pender said, I heard a lot about the guy.
Mm-hmm.
I knew he was a competitor and just really gained a lot of respect from Jim Pender. He's one of the best in the business.
2-1 the count from Co to the lefty Andrew Walker. 2-1 and 2 out. Xavier trailing by 10 here in the top of the 7th.
So Co going to get a visit. It's a pitching coach, Joshua McDonald. He was an entertaining conversation at batting practice. He had a lot of fun. Good things to say.
Well, he is part of the longest tenured staff in Division I baseball. The main core of coaches for UConn has been together for at least 10 years. They won Big East Coaching Staff of the Year this season, no surprise, after winning the regular season conference crown in their first year back in the conference. And an interesting note about Josh McDonald, he has had an All-American pitcher on his staff each of the last 5 fully completed seasons at UConn. Here's the 3-1. Swing and a miss, a heater inside, and that runs the count full.
Foundation just gets stronger, right, in all aspects.
You can make the argument for Ben Kasperius, who we'll see later on this weekend, for an All-American nod. Tough in a shortened season. Of course, UConn has not played the full slate of games that many teams across the country were able to take advantage of due to all the time missed with COVID-19. Here's a ball out to left field. Stock is back on it, and he makes the catch to end the inning. So Coe gets out of a 2-out, 2-on jam, and his team takes a 10-run lead into the stretch here in Mason, Ohio.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix, Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway.
Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now?
And now.
I am.
I am.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints, collectively shaping and forever changing. What makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
11-1 is the score from Prasco Park. Xander Rojan back on the bump for the Xavier Musketeers as we get set to start the bottom of the 7th. Chris Winkle, Eric Stock, Pat Winkle, 2, 3, and 4 due up with the top-seeded UConn Huskies, who are here to prove a little something to the rest of the conference and perhaps some of the fans across the league who wanted to see them play Creighton, the defending 2019 Big East Tournament champions. They were unable to play that regular season series due to weather, due to COVID-19, scheduling with Creighton. Well, more than likely, we'll get to see that matchup tomorrow.
And it's a pretty good opening statement here for Connecticut. That can be a very interesting matchup as well, but I'll tell you what, if you're going to hit the ball like this, 12 hits, and really nothing cheap here for Connecticut. It's going to be a long tournament for the other 3 teams.
Yeah, yeah. They are rich with talent, and as we sort of discussed earlier in the game, you know, the last time UConn won a regular season conference crown was 2011. They won the Big East that year with a few guys named George Springer, Matt Barnes, Nick Ahmed. And they made it all the way to the Super Regional before falling which is the furthest they've made it during the modern 64-team era for the NCAA tournament. And certainly this year making their case to be a formidable foe when the NCAA regional comes around next weekend.
Oh, you're the committee, right? So you're going to look down and see how many runs did they score coming into the end of the season. And like, similar to basketball, what's your resume look like? How you finish the season is a really big part of it. And kind of right now is that category well checked off.
Winkle goes down looking, the first strikeout of the night for Xander Rojan. And now the left fielder Eric Stock will dig in. Nice pitch on the outside corner. Rojan pumped up, making his first Big East tournament appearance in a Xavier uniform. So one down and the base is empty now for the righty Eric Stock, who has reached three out of the four times he's come up to the plate tonight. He also drove in a run back in the fourth. And Stock, a guy who, just as Jim Pender said, has a slow heartbeat. Never too high, never too low, and has done really the most with his second opportunity at the Division I level here at UConn. Of course, he began his career at Old Dominion, played in the infield, as Mike mentioned earlier. Never took a fly ball in the outfield, but sort of had a knack for it when he got to UConn and they decided, we're going to put you out in left field and put your bat at the top part of the order. And that has worked out well for Stock, who throughout the course of the season hit .333, 12 doubles, 25 runs batted in, and a .509 slugging percentage.
You know, we talked about Winkle's draft status. Eric Stock's another guy that they think could go high enough that he would take the offer. And Jim Pender says, you know, if that happens, we're going to miss him.
Oh, and this is high praise, especially on a team like this. But Jim Pender said at times he's been the best hitter in our lineup this season. And that's, you know, coming in a lineup that includes the Big East Player of the Year, Kyler Fedko, a guy who expects to be a future high draft pick in Reggie Crawford, Pat Winkle even at times this year. The 3-1, and Stock draws a walk, fourth time aboard tonight.
And big-time style points as well for Stock with the flow.
He's
nice,
got some good lettuce
coming out of the back. Always good. So Brian Furlong going to have a chat here with Xander Rojan, and that'll be Xander Rojan's night.
We will step aside here in Mason, Ohio for this call to the bullpen brought to you by SoFi. You're watching the Big East Tournament presented by Jeep.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances, designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cashback rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
Luke Bell will take the rock for the Xavier Musketeers, making just his third appearance of the season, the sophomore right-hander out of Chandler, Arizona. Nobody out. One out, rather, and one on, and he'll take on Pat Winkle. Let's send it down to John Fanta, who is in the dugout.
How about an in-game player interview, guys? I'm here with Andy Haig, part of the UConn bench mob. He's a senior for the Huskies. He's from Connecticut. So tell me what the bench mob does.
Well, we just get really weird, and we try and make as much noise as possible and have a lot of fun. That's about it. Oh, I'd also like to say hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Mrs. Haig out there. tonight you're up 11-1, and over the weekend against Seton Hall, you scored 48 runs. What is it about this team that allows everybody to just feed off one another?
Well, we have some elite energy, and a lot of the guys, we just love each other, and nothing makes us happier than when our friends are doing well. Especially, like, you see David Langer, a guy who hasn't played a ton this year, but he just got four hits today, and it's unbelievable. And there's everybody on the bench is so happy for him.
This is the magic of live TV, and I didn't want to say it, so I'll have one of his teammates say it. What did Austin Peterson do before he took the mound tonight?
Oh, God, I have no idea. He probably slept before the first inning. I think he had to go to the bathroom. I think he had to puke, but he's an animal. That's why we were going crazy when he came out. Nothing like a little boot and rally.
That's some good stuff. That's some good stuff. So one of the things that I am curious about, Andy, is you've got the Fedco brothers and you've got the Winkle brothers. What is that dynamic like?
Oh, it's unreal. I mean, we're one big happy family. It's awesome. We're all brothers, I mean, to a certain extent. Christian and Kyler and me and anybody on this team are just as much brothers as they are, like, actual brothers. It's awesome.
What do you think of this ballpark?
Oh, it's unbelievable. Prasco Park, baby. Love it. It's unreal.
Tell me about being fitting back in the Big East this season. You obviously knew coming to UConn, some great memories for the Huskies in the Big East Conference. They've been so successful. And now this is the return year in this conference. What's that been like to renew some of these rivalries, start some new ones?
Yeah, it's unreal. I mean, a lot of us Connecticut guys, we grew up watching the Huskies in the Big East, and it was a little sad when we went to the American because we were going to be playing a lot of unfamiliar teams, and it wasn't the St. John's, the Seton Hall, the Creighton, like the Xavier, the teams that we all know that we grew up watching Big East basketball too, and that was awesome. But it's so nice to be back in the Big East and back where we belong.
Favorite snack?
I'd probably have to go with chicken nuggets.
Favorite movie?
Miracle on Ice.
That's fantastic. You're stuck on an island. You can only do one hobby, and it's not baseball. What are you doing?
I am playing golf for hours on end.
Are you the best golfer on this team?
It's not close.
Wow.
Wow.
Wow, we have confirmation back here.
Wow.
Hold on.
Yeah, he's the best golfer on the team.
Wow.
Johnny, what's his best score for 18?
What's your best score for 18?
18, I shot a 76 at one of the local courses, which is...
He put him on the golf team.
I think that's 5 or 6 over at the local course. It's called Skunkamug, right near UConn. We love that place.
All right. Favorite UConn Husky hooper when you were growing up?
Oh, Kemba Walker, baby. Oh, Kemba, cardiac Kemba, till the day I die.
Wow. Man, Andy Haig, I think we may have to do this again. You've been spectacular.
I'm down, as long as we're winning. I don't want to get in trouble.
Thanks for your time, man.
You're the man. Love it.
All right. That's awesome. That's Andy Haig, guys. I mean, how spectacular was that?
John, I think he's got a future in TV. What do you think?
I think it's the present. And if it's not in TV, the UConn men's golf team did win the Big East title. They're first since the mid-90s. If they needed any help, they should contact Andy Haig. A 76? Shoe, I haven't even come close to that score.
Me neither. I was really excited to shoot 89 when I came here and was bragging about it to you guys, and now Haig shoots a 76.
Schmaltzy, what's your best score?
I get close to 76 a lot, just not, you know, before the 18-hole limit, okay?
Past the turn, though. Here's a two-out walk drawn by Christian Fedco, and that will put two on and two down now for Reggie Crawford. The fans out in right field have been waiting and waiting and waiting tonight for a left-handed hitter to put one into the porch seats. Might this be the time for Reggie Crawford?
Reggie Crawford certainly capable. Langer's put a couple out there.
Langer put one out. Apo Taco bounced off the
delicious
top of the yes, a delicious home run. Just his second of the season. Andy Haig kind of talked about that too. You know, he's a guy that hasn't played a ton this year. But what a night for him. 0-2 count to Crawford.
You know, my only issue with those answers, and I enjoyed all of them, but how does a baseball guy have a favorite movie and it's about hockey?
That's a good question. I thought we were going to get Sandlot. Drop third strike, second strikeout of the inning for Bell. He gets out of the two-out, two-on jam. Xavier will pick up the bats when we come back in the eighth.
If your money is working toward the same goals, why keep it in different places? SoFi is a one-stop shop for your finances, designed to work better together. Spend with SoFi and get cash back rewards that automatically go toward your goals, like investing in stocks, ETFs, and crypto. That's better together. Or pay down your SoFi debt sooner. That's better together. And that's how SoFi is helping millions get their money right.
It is 11-1, UConn Huskies. Garrett Coe back on the circle, back on the mound for the top-seeded team in the tournament. They've won 25 of their last 30 games. If that's not hot, I don't know what is. Still a big crowd on hand here late into the night for round number one of this four-day tournament over Memorial Day weekend. Here is Coe to Manastrup, and he misses upstairs for a ball. After missing the tournament last year due to COVID-19, I think, Mike, it's safe to say that everybody here just ecstatic to be back at the ballpark and seeing good baseball again. And as James Green, the director of Big East Championships, talked about, you know, just being at Prasco Park again, unrestricted.
Yeah, it's that familiar, comfortable feel, and this is what summer's supposed to feel like, sort of
yes.
The unofficial kickoff to summer this weekend, and it's great to see. It's great to see the support that was here today. You know, that grandstand out in right field was filled when we started. Just a great event and a great celebration of baseball. You know, the Musketeers able to bring some fans out locally, but just a great place to celebrate the end of the season.
Here's a line drive in the left field by Manastra, his second time aboard today. And now 2-for-4 with a single and a double to lead things off here in the eighth.
He talked about leading by example there for Natalia Manastra. Well, we're down 11 to run. And this guy's still making hits. He's still hitting quality at bats.
Here is Jared Cushing. If you're Jim Penders, you got to be real pleased with as deep as Austin Peterson went. Six full innings. Now Coe's back out for his second. And Coe has only tossed 28 pitches. So it's possible that he finishes this game. And the top tier of the bullpen for UConn still intact going right into day two of the tournament.
And how's that going to look for Creighton Blue Jays coming up? What are they thinking right now? Any other kind of scary part of that UConn offense tonight, they've left 10 on base.
Yikes.
So this could be a little more inflated than it is right now.
Two, one. Big swing and a miss from Cushing. Levels the count at two apiece.
So for Xavier in this situation, if you plan on winning this tournament, and they do, time to take notes and absorb as much as you can here against Coe. You'll probably see him again, and that is a blazing fastball for the strikeout.
number two for Coe. And now Tyler DeMartino will stand in. You know, we talked, Mike, about UConn and kind of the accolades that this team has garnered this year and the similarities they've drawn between themselves and the 2011 team with all the major league players on it that went to the Super Regional. This is a UConn team that's in search of their seventh trip to the NCAA tournament since 2010.
Just impressive throughout. Yeah. We've talked about the tradition and how it's going to build. And not quite to the level of the women's basketball team there at UConn, but kind of getting close. And that's how it can build, right? And then the players start finding you.
Great play in right field. Sliding to make it was Kyler Fedko, the Big East Player of the Year, flashing some leather down the right field line. That was actually Christian Fedko, Kyler's brother, tracking it down from right field.
Well, effort play there late in the game, so 11-1. You know, you might think about letting that one drop, right?
Maybe not
the
Fedko
brothers. Don't overexert yourself.
Not
you don't
want to
risk an injury there, but the Fedko's going right after it.
They go right after it all the time, guys. I actually have a great story courtesy of John Fedko, the father to Kyler and Christian. And last weekend, when Kyler was heading to the plate for his last at-bat of the regular season, Christian walked up to Kyler and said, "Hey, you need a hit to get to 400 on your season." And what does Kyler Fedko do? He hits a three-run home run. There is two brothers motivating each other and putting a bond on display on the diamond.
It's a fantastic story, and what a great way to get your 400th.
Here's a sky-high pop-up into center field. It's Chris Winkle, part of the other set of brothers, the Winkle brothers and the Fedko brothers, helping to lead this UConn team to a 10-run lead as we head to the home half of the eighth from Mason, Ohio.
I'm from Chicago.
Cleveland.
Phoenix. Milwaukee.
Hartford.
Colorado.
Oklahoma.
Thailand.
Norway. Cameroon.
And I chose.
I chose Xavier University.
For business.
Chemical science.
Occupational therapy.
Philosophy, politics, and the public.
Computer science.
Because it felt like home.
I knew I would be welcome.
Because they take care of veterans.
I felt connected to the campus.
To the people.
The sports.
I came here to be a Musketeer. And now.
And now.
I am.
I am.
I am.
All for one.
Though we are many, we are part of something. A force. Bigger than all of us. Our distinct fingerprints, collectively shaping and forever changing. What makes UConn, UConn. Forever making our mark. Forever making UConn a part of us.
Back to the ballpark in Mason, Ohio. It's a 10-run lead for the UConn Huskies. Great to have UConn back in the conference. They last won this tournament in their final year in the Big East before transitioning to the American in 2013, trying to sort of bookend their hiatus from the Big East Conference with another tournament win. Here in 2021, it would be the fourth Big East Conference Tournament championship in program history. Their men's track and field program did the same earlier this spring. They won in 2013, come back and won it in 2021. And you get the sense from every program across the board for UConn athletics, they want to win in their first year back in the conference. Set the tone, let everybody know the big dog is back.
Right. It's like your grandparents coming back, reestablishing their authority. Hey, we were the original members of this conference, right?
Yeah.
Come back, make a statement. So there's a little game within a game here. So Longer, 4-for-4 with a home run. And Luke Bell, the only Musketeer pitcher to hold the Huskies scoreless in an inning. How's that for some deep thought? late in the game.
Monastra going to get a little tape job here. Yeah, Bell came in, struck out two, walked a batter, and got out of the seventh inning unscathed. The only inning tonight in which the Huskies did not score at least a run. They've scored two or more in four of six innings. Monastra all good. Back to the mound to chat things over with Luke Bell, taking on David Langer, Chris Brown, and Zach Bushling, the 7, 8, and 9 hitters who have been splendid tonight in the opening round of the Big East tournament.
Yeah, Matt, that's actually Matt Dupre, who's the backup catcher here for the Musketeers, a freshman. He's made a couple starts this season, so he'll get a chance to work with Luke Bell, and they expect to be making some exchanges as they move through the Xavier system here.
So there's your first change defensively tonight for either team, understanding what lies ahead for the Musketeers. Dupre taking over for Natale Monastra, who's caught a lot of innings, not only tonight but throughout the season. And he will be counted on in a must-win elimination game tomorrow night against the Seton Hall Pirates. And, of course, whether it's the Pirates or the Musketeers who come away victorious tomorrow, one of those teams, if they're going to win the tournament, they got to win four straight games through Sunday.
Certainly an uphill climb. It's part of just playing in this tournament. But you have to start to plan ahead.
Yeah, rest always important. You know, how far can your bullpen go? And Xavier's definitely going to need a quality start out of either Bosacker or Link or Flam or whoever they throw out there tomorrow.
And how does Seton Hall respond from what happened earlier today?
Right, I think that's a great question, John. You know, that's a team that had 17 hits. They walked 11 batters, and yet they had a chance to win. They were winning by three as we went into the home half of the ninth inning, and it looked, John, like justice was going to be served. Seton Hall was back and forth in that game, finally took ahead and was in the driver's seat, but Creighton continuing to hold that elusive win over the heads of the Pirates in this tournament.
Mm.
Drop third strike. Langer tagged out. Third strike out of the night for Luke Bell.
Yeah, first time Langer's been retired here tonight. So Bell making a little bit of a statement of his own. Little chance for some more innings here.
In steps Chris Brown with one down. John, what do you think about that for Seton Hall just as far as approach tomorrow against the Xavier team?
Well, I would expect that they throw David Festa, who is a good arm. He actually has better numbers than Ryan McClinsky, who we saw today. It was just such an uncharacteristic performance by Seton Hall. Not in the fact that they lost to Creighton. We've seen them lose to Creighton before. And not the fact that Creighton came back in the ninth inning. It's more to me about the 11 free passes. When you think of Seton Hall baseball, you think of the little things. You would never compute, as there's a strikeout, that their pitchers would walk 11 hitters. And that's the thing that has to sting the most. I think Seton Hall played pretty well today, besides those 11 free passes. They did a lot of little things offensively. Ed Service even said to us guys that he felt like they could win today's game. And here they are now having to win four in a row. So it's more about a mental factor. And you need to come up in the first inning, and you've got to prove yourself right off the bat. It's a really hard thing to do. But I think in that elimination game between the losers today, it's for me, it's who scores first, who sets the tone. Because if you lost, then you have to battle back from another deficit early on in your elimination game, too. You could wilt. You really could wilt mentally.
Plus, if you're Seton Hall, that game was emotional. This game really hasn't had a lot of emotion to it because UConn's been in the driver's seat since inning number one. But, you know, Seton Hall probably felt like multiple times in that game, Mike, they should have won. They should be in the winner's bracket scouting UConn right now for day two of this tournament.
Well, I know we were polishing up our Pirate stats, right, for the end of that game, and that turn on a dime with that big inning.
Yep.
There in the bottom of the ninth.
How about this, guys? I got the number of the day for you. Here it is. This is our stat in the game presented by SoFi.
Late night with John Fanta. Lay it on us.
Fanta after dark.
Since joining the Big East, and in baseball, that's 2014 for Creighton. Creighton has beaten Seton Hall seven times. Seven times Creighton's beaten Seton Hall when the Blue Jays have entered the ninth inning trailing or tied.
Wow.
So that's a win a year where they've trailed Seton Hall or been tied heading into the ninth, and they've ended up beating Seton Hall. And to me, it's unbelievable when you think about the fact that Creighton is 7-0 in the Big East tournament against the Pirates, especially when you both consider, I think we've all been talking about it, Seton Hall's been in the driver's seat in the last two Big East tournaments in that opener, and they just have not been able to finish. And you have to credit David Vilches, Dax Roper, and Hanifan, because for Creighton, we talked about the 5-8 hitters in their lineup and how poor they've been at times. Well, guess what? Those are the guys that decided the game today with hits.
And, John, it's interesting you bring up the fact that, you know, Seton Hall has given up leads to Creighton in many of these tournament wins that the Blue Jays have pulled out. When I was leaving the booth to go get a bite, little Montgomery in with the sweet sauce, a couple of the Creighton players were walking out of the dugout behind me, and one of them said, "Did you ever have a doubt?" And the other teammate said, "Absolutely not. I knew we were going to win this game."
Matt, even our feeling in the booth, right? We stayed on. We didn't go to our commercial break heading in the bottom of the ninth because you have to tell that story of how this has gone. It's been, tail of the tape has been evidence that the Creighton Blue Jays, you can never say die with them. And that is a credit to Ed Service's program. But particularly against Seton Hall, they just have kept on fighting. And so now the Pirates, that's the biggest question in my mind, is how do they respond from such a devastating loss? And then I think that the biggest question for this tournament as a whole, everybody needs to bear in mind, Creighton and UConn have not met yet.
Right.
They have not met. And Creighton's the reigning champions, and they feel like they're not getting enough talk. UConn is a top 20 RPI team playing as well as anybody right now in college baseball. So how do these two forces collide in their first meeting? I can't wait. I'm excited. I don't know if I'll sleep tonight.
Andrew Sexton batting for Garrett Schultz. John, I think you and a lot of folks probably feel the same way. This has been probably the most highly anticipated matchup of the year, especially since they didn't get to play in the regular season due to scheduling and COVID-19. Now we finally get to see it when it means the most in the Big East tournament.
Yeah, I mean, it's like a great Memorial Day cookout.
What snack are you bringing to the ballpark for the cookout?
Well, I'm a popcorn guy through and through.
Yeah. Get your popcorn ready. It could be a lot of fireworks tomorrow. A
little chocolate-covered pretzel. maybe a little what's the zebra gum?
Oh, what a play. Oh, it's the fruit gum.
Yeah. What's the name of it?
You got me stumped.
You're catching me. I can see it.
Hold on.
Lime was my favorite flavor. It had the stripes. Hit a little zebra on there with different colors. That was a double there from Sexton.
Yeah, oh, nice hit. Double for Sexton.
Fruit stripe.
The pinch hit.
Just fruit stripe gum.
Fruit stripe. There it is.
Love that stuff. I'm a big Airhead guy, too.
You're talking about the candy, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Tootsie Rolls. Tootsie Rolls. I mean, I can tell you guys right now, we're in the ninth inning. We've been on the air since, what, 2:30?
Right.
I could use a Miller Lite right now.
There you go.
Uh-oh.
Hey now.
Fanta after dark. Watch
hey
out.
Now.
Here is Jeff Holtz. Nobody out and a runner at second base and a sky-high pop-up behind home. And
my God,
Pat
that's
Winkle will watch it sail out of play.
That's hit to Mars. How about all the guests we've had tonight, right?
It's been like
it's
talk
an all-star
show.
Cast. It has been.
The Tonight Show. From Prasco Park.
We should take some phone calls from fans.
Hop into your Twitter mentions. I'm sure you've got tens of hundreds.
Hey, by the way, I want to congratulate our partner, Matt Schumacher, on the birth of his beautiful daughter, Bella.
Yes.
Thank you, John.
Congrats, buddy.
She is. She has since gone to bed, but her and wifey were up late watching the game tonight.
Ah.
She turned 7 weeks old on Tuesday.
Beautiful pictures you showed us yesterday. We saw Bella's recliner there in the bathtub, very comfortable way.
She is adorable.
Well, I credit my wife for that.
You're humble. I think she's going to have a really good running career.
You know what? I would like that. Soccer, but I would love softball. I want to be at the Diamond on Memorial Day weekend, John, at a super regional.
I love that. You in the booth.
Now
and Bella around in third. Let's make it happen.
The count is 1-2 to Jeff Holtz. He has Andrew Sexton at second base. Coe still on the mound for UConn.
I'll tell you what, Garrett Coe, he looks like a guy that I could go out for pizza with. Like he's a big fella.
That bill's going to be pretty big, John.
Yeah, 6'6", 276.
Yeah.
Who's buying, John?
He's going to order four and then look at you and say, what do you want?
Now, he's an imposing presence on the rubber. And you know what? When you go on a championship run, you cannot discount what these innings mean.
Right.
When you come into a game and just eat these up. And that's what Garrett's being asked to do here, and he's eating them up.
And he's doing it well, too. I mean, this isn't a guy who's, coming in for fluff. He had a sub-2 ERA in 7 outings. He gave up 1 run over those 7 outings. Hasn't given up a run here yet to Xavier, and he just picked up his 3rd strikeout, John, and he's got some years left. This is his 2nd season, but his 1st full one in a UConn uniform.
Again, with every strikeout, every pitch he's got, where he's hitting his location, seeing that ball doing what he wants it to do, that confidence builds for him as well.
Stevenson coming in for Luke Franzoni. Well, we've been on the air, as John said, since about 2 o'clock this afternoon. And here is Tony Suarez, one of our esteemed cameramen for the Rush Media crew. Adam Schrand, another cameraman. Adam Schrand, wave to the crowd, my friend. You guys deserve a lot of praise. Standing out in the elements, it's hot out. Now it's cold. Adam still got the T-shirt on, though. I got to admire that.
Yeah, those guys deserve a lot of credit. They really do. I mean,
my man Alec DeFord, what's going on, brother? Out in the tower in the outfield, shorts and a T-shirt and a salute on Memorial Day.
Jason Dudley,
J.D., fresh off of track and field in Ohio, in Geneva, Ohio, a couple of weekends ago. He's here with us, all-star crew this weekend here at Prasco Park. Swing and a miss from Stevenson. He's down on strike, so back-to-back Ks for Cole. That's his 4th, and 2 away in the 9th.
Can't forget about Kevin Brawlinthan, our wonderful colleague who does so many different things for Rush Media and our Big East Digital crew throughout the year, and then our folks Bobby Mullen, Rick Gentile, Kristen Quinn, Media Relations here, Pam Flanke, John Paquette, Nicole Early, all those folks. Ben Piasek, all those folks. Kristen Quinn's practically been our utility tonight. she's tracking the interviews down. But seriously, you guys know it. We're the broadcasters, but there's so many people here throughout this chaotic spring who have been vital to getting us from tournament to tournament. My goodness.
Yeah, and I just want to finish, John. You know, Brandon Curtis, the replay.
Yeah.
Beth Guggenheim on graphics. Mike Young, camera from the booth.
Fro!
You know, Nathan McGehe, utility. Matt Hodges, who's been directing and kind of bringing us all the sights and sounds. And, of course, Ryan McGehe, who's running the show as the producer this weekend. And there's a lot that goes into it, John. You know, talking with James Green as the director of championships, there are so many folks here from Rush Media, from the Big East Conference, that put in a lot of hours, much more hours than we do on air, to make this Engine Go, and it is my favorite event, and I know for you guys it's one of your favorites too throughout the whole year, no matter the sport or the conference. This is truly top-notch.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an honor to be a part of it. And very gracious and grateful to have the invitation.
That'll do it. UConn comes away with their first Big East tournament win since 2013. How about Garrett Coase? 5 strikeouts, including 3 in the ninth. An 11-1 win for the UConn Huskies. An emphatic reintroduction to the Big East tournament.
Yeah, we were talking about legal arbitration earlier. Fantastic opening statement here for the UConn Huskies. Matt, you mentioned they want to get back into this conference, show them how it's done, and this is a great way to do it. 11 runs, 12 hits, only shut out in 2 innings here tonight. And the scary part about it, again, they left 10 on base.
Another scary part about it, they only used 2 pitchers. Ben Kasperius gets the start tomorrow afternoon in the winner's bracket. It'll be UConn-Creighton. All you fans at home who stayed up late to watch the end of this one, you finally get the matchup you've been asking and calling for all season long. The 2013 UConn Big East Tournament champs against the defending Big East Tournament champs from 2019 in the Creighton Blue Jays.
Yeah, Creighton played like that today. Big comeback victory with a 4-run bottom of the
David.
Ninth. Got a nice walk-off,
David.
An emotional one there from Hannifin, and we'll see how they come to play tomorrow. You know, Ed Service was clear in our conversations yesterday that they are the defending champions, and they're going to have a chance to prove it.
Well, certainly UConn got a lot of great offense tonight, John Fanta, and really you don't have to look any further than David Langer, who had 4 hits, including a home run to right field, a little Oppo Taco action, and you're now joined with him field side.
David, congratulations on this Big East tournament opener win, a 4-hit night. Tell me why you were so locked in tonight at the plate.
Coach Horgan gave a really good scouting report on the starter. We'd faced him earlier in the year and knew what we were going to get. Just looking for pitches over the middle of the plate, things we could hit.
Break down the home run, your 2nd of the season, what you were looking for in that at-bat and the feeling for you to hit one over the brick wall out and right.
2-0. Knew I was getting a fastball. 2 strikes or 2 outs, and so I was like, got to try to drive a ball. Got a fastball up and away. Actually kind of missed it. I didn't think it was leaving, but then I saw the right fielder looking up, and I was like, nice. I guess I got more juice than I thought.
This team, over the last 5 games, has outscored your competition 59-12. On the offensive side, 7 different players had an RBI tonight, David. What is it like going 1-9 right now, knowing that in any given moment anybody can come up with that knock?
Oh, it's awesome to know that, you know, every guy, it's not 1-9, there's guys on the bench too that are ready to go. Every guy can get a hit, every guy can, you know, we all bring something unique to the table, and, you know, you can see it. I think pretty much everyone got a hit today. There's no easy outs in our lineup.
You will meet Creighton tomorrow. What are you expecting from the first meeting with the Blue Jays? Finally.
I mean, obviously I haven't seen them, but we know they're good. Watched them play a little bit earlier today. Hopefully just keep it up with the offense because, you know, scoring 10 runs a game is it's a good recipe for success.
All right, through the next hour, last one for me. Superstition, a snack, a phone call to somebody. Like, what are you doing right now, David Langer, when you go back to the hotel? What's going on?
Anything special? My only superstition is that I don't have superstitions. I think they're dumb. I think they're just a sign of fear. They're because you're afraid of something. So, yeah, I don't have them.
David, say goodnight to UConn Husky Nation.
Thank you.
There he is. That's David Langer. Back up to you, Matt and Mike.
I love it. David Langer's all business, and he was all business tonight, Schmolte. He was 4-for-5, and he had a home run to boot to deep right field.
Yeah, great night for Langer. Great night for the entire offense there for the Huskies. They rack up 11 runs, beat a good Xavier team 11-1 in a team that, you know, we all thought would challenge the Huskies, be one of the better challengers, and maybe an early knockout punch here for the Huskies.
That is what everyone's gunning for
Four teams, 4 days, double elimination. One team at the end of this weekend will be crowned Big East Tournament Kings. UConn and Creighton in the matchup we've all waited for. In the winner's bracket tomorrow, Seton Hall and Xavier in our first elimination game. For Mike Schmaltz, for John Fanta, for Ryan McGahey, and our entire digital crew from Rush Media, I'm Matt Schumacher signing off from Prasco Park in day one of the Big East Baseball Tournament.